says these owls can't fly? The Rice Owls would rather take flight on the ground, where quarterback Bert Emanuel soars free. Fred Goldsmith's defense, on the other hand, does like to fly, towards the ball, that is, where they've been hawking opposing quarterbacks this year. UT faithful continue to stand proud despite a troubling start. The Longhorns' offense is bullish on taking to the air and have the birds to do it. But Texas' concern all season has been how to bring the opposing offenses to ground. We'll see if they can do it tonight. Live from Memorial Stadium in Austin, Texas, Home Sports Entertainment, in association with Special Order Sports, presents Southwest Conference Football. This evening, the Texas Longhorns host the Rice Owls. Hello, everyone. I'm Bill Lang. Glad to have you aboard for the Southwest Conference opener in league play, with Rice and Texas to go at it tonight here in Austin. Now, most of the time, in fact, for 27 years, you just look at this one and you put down a Texas W. That's the streak. 27 consecutive wins by Texas over Rice. That is a long time, and to give you an idea, the coaches, the last time that Rice won against Texas, which was here in Austin, 1965, well, Texas legend Darrell Royal, and on the other side, Rice coach Jess Neely. Now, let's go to the current. Texas is struggling. A winless September, 0-2-1. They were shellacked last week by Louisville. They played outstanding competition. All their teams that they have met have been nationally ranked. On the other side, though, Rice is a team that is an upstart. They come in at 3-1. They lost their opener at Ohio State, where they were rocked. Since then, they've won three in a row, including a clobbering of Iowa State last weekend. Sets the stage for an interesting matchup, and a call it for you tonight. We'll go upstairs to Bill Worrell and Ed Biles.
All right, Bill, thank you so much. Ed, last week, Jeff Brohm of Louisville was able to light that Texas defensive secondary up. Now, they're going to face a different type quarterback in Bert Emanuel tonight. They're really going to have to try to contain him.
Well, they've faced some good ones so far this year, but this one has tremendous speed. Emanuel is the fastest quarterback in the country, high school, college, or pro. He can run. The option is his favorite. It's going to be interesting to see whether Tubbs, as he comes off that corner, can stop Emanuel running the option.
The Texas Longhorns feel like they need an identity. They haven't been able to run very well, nor have they been able to pass. And I've got a feeling tonight they're going to turn and hand the ball to Phil Brown.
Well, Phil Brown's a fine back. He's their leading rusher, obviously. But he's also their second leading receiver, so he can do both of it. They give the ball to him enough, they're going to come with some play action stuff and get it in his hands. He's strong, he's powerful, and does have those soft hands from a receiving standpoint.
Defensively, we're going to see a couple of great linebackers tonight. And on the Rice Owl side, it will be Emmett Waldron, the Irishman. And he averages about 9 tackles a game.
Really interesting story. He's an Irish immigrant, doesn't have his citizenship papers yet. Really strong, tough. Going to have his hands full, because I believe you're going to see Texas try to run the football this evening.
Winfred Tubbs was headed for an All-American season. He had that accident before the year started, but we saw him start to round into shape last week.
Well, his hands are coming around. Of course, he's a 6'5", 240-pounder. It's going to be extremely important for Tubbs now to play the option. He has to take the option keep away from Emanuel in this football game. That's the real key from Texas' defensive standpoint.
None of these players were born the last time the Rice Owls defeated the Texas Longhorns, and they're hoping tonight they can break the jinx. Let's go back down to the field now, and here's Bill Land.
Thanks, Bill. Yeah, Texas is hoping history repeats itself as they try to make a 28 in a row over Rice, and they've also won 18 straight league openers. We've got the kickoff coming up, Texas and Rice, on Special Order Sports in a moment. Tonight's Southwest Conference football game is being brought to you by Southwest Airlines, offering frequent flights and everyday low fares, which is why flying Southwest Airlines is just plain smart.
There's not a prettier sight anywhere in the world as the sun sets on the hill country. Austin, Texas, Memorial Stadium for Southwest Conference football. The University of Texas Longhorns against the Rice Owls tonight. And the weather tonight, well, they called for a cold front to move in here, and it hasn't gotten here, of course. As you can see, 90 degrees. The humidity is down, and the wind is down, usually out of the south in double figures, but tonight blowing only about 6 miles per hour, so the wind may not be much of a factor. The officials for tonight's game, Lloyd Dale, the veteran referee, Max Smythe, and then Gary Slaughter will be the head linesman as you look down the line of officials here tonight. Fred Goldsmith, in his fifth season with the Rice Owls, last year 6-5, the first winning season at Rice in 29 years. And he really has high hopes. He's off to a great start this season. And John Makovic, 6-5, also last season, former quarterback at Wake Forest, and he's trying to get this Texas program back in the winning ways. The series record, it goes all the way back to 1914 as Texas has a whopping lead. Rice won the coin toss and deferred to Texas, so the Longhorns will receive the football, defending the North goal. And the Rice Owls, wearing the white travel jersey, will be kicking it off. Johnny Bagwell will be booting to Mike Adams, one of the premier return men in all of college football. Adams averaging 36 yards on his kickoff returns. He had an 80-yarder against Syracuse. This is right down about a yard deep in the end zone. Adams across the 30. He could go, and a touchdown saving tackle by the Owls. Looked like Johnny Bagwell, the kicker, may have made the tackle. That was a 38-yard return by Adams.
Well, they had a wedge right up the middle. He goes right up into the wedge, and then he breaks it there, sees it opening out to the left. Now he uses his tremendous speed to get outside, take it up there before he's finally brought down. Another, see the wedge. You can see the good shot of the wedge. That's a good shot of the wedge, how they form, how they come close together, try to block people all the way. Bagwell has to make the tackle.
Jay Morentz is back in the starting lineup. Curtis Jackson, Phil Brown in the backfield, and the handoff to the deep back going across midfield. And actually, that was Anthony Holmes who was starting in place of Jackson, and he carried for a gain of 11.
Well, they did that last week, Bill. They started Holmes in that first play, and he ran the ball.
Morentz was replaced at halftime last week against Louisville. He's off to a slow start. Only one touchdown pass this season and six interceptions. The backs and receivers, Matt Davis in for the suspended Lavelle Pinckney. And keep an eye, of course, on Adams. I formation, Longhorns at midfield. Curtis Jackson across left guard for a gain of about three. And Michael Shirt making the tackle for the Rice Owls, and the offensive line for Texas, and it is a big one. Brockemeyer is the all-star in that lineup at right tackle.
6'6", 280 pounds, Brockemeyer.
Aren't any small ones. The smallest offensive lineman, John Elmore, at 272. Split backs for Shea Morentz. Second down, Texas. Phil Brown around the left side. He's got a blocker inside the 40-yard line. And another first down for Texas. And the Longhorns, saying that they seek an identity, are running that football. The defense for Rice will be four down linemen. Corey Seymour and Derek Rutherford are the big ones there for Rice. And keep an eye on Emmett Waldron, Larry Izzo on the small side, and Joe Davis is averaging about eight tackles a game. The defensive backs, Sean Washington, is the big play man for the Rice Owls. Well, there is Waldron, who has three sacks on the season, averaging about nine tackles a game. And if you want to watch the football, just watch number 50. He usually ends up where it stops.
Second team all Southwest Conference, his sophomore year.
Jackson and Brown in the backfield, split. First and 10, Texas. On the Rice 37-yard line, first pass of the game. Morentz over the middle, a short pass. A reception at about the 35-yard line. Jimmy Hakes on the reception. A little extracurricular activity.
Well, they don't play this game with short pass, Bill, so occasionally you see guys hit each other. Good pass protection. The key to this pass was, take a look at Brockemeyer right there in the middle screen. Good feet, good balance. Plenty of time for Morentz to complete the pass over the middle to Hakes.
Shirk at about 250, and look at Brockemeyer at 286. He is really something to watch. Second down, about six to go for Texas.
Nice showing blitz.
Morentz to Jackson around the left side. There's a fumble. Will it stay in play? No, it goes out of bounds. And actually, it takes a Texas bounce. And the ball fumbled forward by Jackson on the play.
Oh, that's a tough break. Here's the toss. This is the toss sweep into the short side of the field. Rice hadn't played very well. They came up, and there's a tackle right there. But see, the ball is fumbled forward, and actually, he's going to wind up picking up. The official discussing over there whether he can do that or not. They brought the ball back to the original spot. I didn't think he could fumble the ball forward and pick up positive yardage. So they gave him the spot where the ball was originally fumbled. They didn't allow him to shovel the ball forward out of bounds and pick up that extra 5 yards.
Well, Larry Izzo forced that play outside. Nathan Bennett was the man for Rice to strip the ball. Now Jackson will check back into the game. And Hakes will be coming out.
Rice coming with a blitz on that second down play. Let's see whether they play it safe or they go after him here on third down and 6, Bill. They're playing back. Playing zone.
Moritz across the middle, well covered by the Rice Owls, will be short of the first down.
That's completion, but not enough for the first down. Interesting decision now here for Coach McEwen. You go for it on fourth down, or do you go for the settle for the field goal? I have a feeling he may go for it. I think he wants to show confidence to the team here this evening. Get this crowd fired up. It'll be fourth down and about one. And he's made his decision.
Joe Davis was on the tackle for Rice, so the first key down of the ball game. Fourth down, and the Longhorns need about 2 yards.
Everybody on their feet early in this ball game.
Pitch back, and it looked like it.
Depends on the spot.
Brown had trouble with the pitch back from Morentz, and let's do look at the spot. Now, Brown says it's a first down.
I think they gave him a very favorable spot.
Emmett Waldron and Joe Davis on the tackle for Rice.
It's going to be close. This is all on the spot of the official.
He did not have a handle on that football when he started to run.
Well, it's going to be close. This is going to be about 3 inches one way or the other, I believe.
Did he get it? I don't think he got it. First down, Rice. And the Owls hold on the first series of downs.
Boy, what a big play for the Rice defense. What a big confidence builder for the Rice football team.
Well, the Owls now will get it at their own 27-yard line. And Bert Emanuel, the senior out of Houston, will be at the controls. And there you see what he's done on the season. 57% of his pass attempts. He has passed for 4 touchdowns and no interceptions. And keep an eye on his backs. A big tight end, Clemente Torres. Yancey Edmonds filling in for Trevor Cobb as he has graduated. Jimmy Lee is the go-to man for Emmanuel. First down and 10, Rice. Emmanuel has got a scout right on him. Throws it to Torres. Oh, what a hit by Texas. Joey Ellis. Clemente Torres never saw Ellis coming.
But Ellis was questionable all week with a bad ankle. That showing signs of being hurt there. He didn't hardly work out in yesterday's practice. Out there playing tonight, what a hit he laid on him.
Ed Torres is 235 pounds. Ellis only 181. But he had the advantage of coming straight in on the play. Now Ed Howard is 6'4". He will go against Ellis. And they're flanked out to the top of your screen. Second down, Rice. 4 wide receivers for the Owls. Going long, Emmanuel's got a man. 40-yard line down to the 30, and he's run out of bounds. At about the 30-yard line, Chris Carter runs Byron Costin out of bounds, the junior from Humboldt. And he is a fleet-footed young man who can pick him up and lay him down. 48 yards
the key
from Emmanuel.
The key to this build, watch the pass protection. Long, look at that pass protection. He's got plenty of time, and he lost it after. No question about the strength of his arm. Look at the block on Watkins. Great job. He just sat back in a rocking chair there. Perfectly thrown over the shoulder. Costin couldn't regain his balance, or he might have taken it all the way.
Yancey Edmonds, big hole up the middle as he runs over right guard inside the Texas 20-yard line. Winfred Tubbs on the tackle for Texas. We'll check out that offensive line. This is a good one. Etherington, the center, anchors it. Cooley, Eklund, Gray, and Golden, they are a veteran unit coming in for the Rice Owls. And they are big. Golden at 280, 280 for Gray, 285 Etherington, 280 for Eklund, and 290 for Cooley. Second down, the Owls need 4. Lee is in motion. Hand off Edmonds again. Big hole over the right side. He's at the 10-yard line. touchdown saving tackle at the 10.
You know the interesting thing so far? Everybody was looking for Emmanuel to run the option. He hasn't run the option yet, Bill. They've been doing it with a passing and a running game.
Watch the blocks up front.
Look at the hole he's got when he gets through there. Makes a nice move right here to break out to the right side. Great offensive line block. Good job by Hetherington, Gray, and Eklund in the middle of that line.
Yancey Edmonds has some big cleats to fill. Trevor Cobb, an All-American, a four-year starter for the Owls, but Edmonds has stepped it up, and he's doing a good job.
They're blitzing now. He gets through the line. He's got good yardage.
Inside the 10, he's tripped up down to about the 8. Tripped up at the line of scrimmage by Texas. Tony Brackens might have been in there along with Tubbs. There you see Watkins and Baskin, Clark, and Bosick. Along the front line, Robert Reed, a youngster that has big play capabilities, Tubbs we talked about. And the backs, Ellis you've already seen, Van Malone, the five-year starter. Second down and 9. Emmanuel on the quarterback draw. Texas sniffs it out, but they missed a tackle. Emmanuel is down to about the 5-yard line. They had him in the backfield, but could not contain him, Ed.
Well, he's got that quickness, and he has that ability to, when he makes a move, he doesn't lose speed. Now, watch when he makes the move right there. He's going just as fast going to the outside as he was when he was coming up forward. People with great speed and quickness, they don't lose that. Some guys, when they make a move one way or the other, they have to regain that speed, but he keeps that speed. Big third down play here now.
Actually, the Owls can get a first down at about the 1-yard line. They need 4 for the first. Emmanuel changing the play. Hand off Yancey Edmonds. And Texas is there. Tony Brackens, the first one to Edmonds at the 4-yard line. And that will set up a fourth down, and Fred Goldsmith will go for the field goal. Johnny Bagwell has a good leg. He's 1 for 3 this season.
And this is just about like an extra point, though, Bill. He's 14. He's perfect on extra points, and that's about all this is an extra point, as tight as they are in there right now.
Kurt Roper will be holding. Call it 23 yards. Bagwell just punches it up and through. And the Rice Owls draw first blood in this ball game with 8:24 left to play in the first quarter. And it's the Rice Owls 3, the Texas Longhorns nothing. Well, we welcome you back to Memorial Stadium in Austin, Texas, where the Rice Owls have moved that football right down the field, aided by a big pass and run play from Bert Emanuel to Byron Costin. Big play by Rice.
Yeah, that was an outstanding opening drive for Rice, Bill. They really mixed things up. Everybody was probably anticipating Emanuel to run a lot of options. They didn't use the option that drive. Did a good job of Edmonds running inside. Of course, the big long pass to Costin was the big play in the drive. And very difficult when you get to that 10-yard line. For some reason, it's very hard to put the ball into the end zone. I mean, that's just the toughest place in the world to go 10 yards to get a touchdown.
And a 69-yard drive by the Rice Owls in 8 plays. And it only took 3:15, so a quick strike by Rice. And the Texas Longhorns, Ed, are still trying to do something offensively. About the only offense for Texas has been kickoff returns by this man, Mike Adams.
Well, they've done a great job. They had the running game going pretty good there on that first drive, Bill. I would think they'll settle down and stay maybe with that running game a little bit. There's a ranking conference, Frank. Texas, of course, number one in the conference with kickoff returns, averaging 30 yards. A kickoff return. TCU, Baylor, Rice down there in fifth position.
Well, Adams is most of that, averaging 36 yards a return. That's good for seventh in the nation. He'll take this one right at the goal line. Ball bounces up. And and he's off to the races across the 20 to about the 21, and it seems like every time a speedster drops a football, something big happens, but the Owls were on it.
Well, I find this very interesting, Bill. The Rice Owls, who normally sometimes come in with maybe a little lack of confidence, they're saying, kick it to you, Adams. You're the best. We're going to come and get you. And I think they've taken a very positive approach to this ball game, preparing themselves, saying that we're not afraid of you. Normally, I think there's a little hesitation. You try to devise ways. They kick the ball right to him both times.
Jay Morant so far in this game at 100%, but not for a lot of yardage. Jackson and Brown in the backfield. And he'll flip it to Brown. Across the 20 to about the 22. That was Jackson. Jeffrey Mercer on the tackle for Rice. Rutherford was also around the football, but Mercer will go get him.
Well, it's just a toss to Jackson going into the end of the sideline. As you can see, he's taking the ball into that short sideline. And so far, Texas has run several plays from the hash marks into the short sideline. Evidently, they felt like they had something going that they could do against Rice.
Looks like Rice has pretty good pursuit. They don't know the football very well. Lorenz will hand it to Jackson again. Flags on the play. Big hole left side.
Oh,
Jackson gets outside to the 30. He's at the 40 down the left sideline to midfield before he's run out of bounds by Rice. But we'll have to check the flags. There was a flag on the play. Nathan Bennett was the Owl to knock Curtis Jackson out of bounds.
I think we're going to see an offside probably against Rice. I think this is one of the things that these officials, there wasn't anybody jumped. But looking at several games in the Southwest Conference today, I've noticed officials are calling them awfully close with the defensive linemen are lining up. That was counter play. Good little shove block over there, but Jackson made a great move to the inside, then used his speed to go back out to the outside and take it down to the sideline. He made a good move from the inside to get back out to the outside.
Jackson, one of the outstanding freshmen in the country last year from Plano, and he's got 27 yards rushing on four carries. Looking long, he will air it out. And nothing there. Adams and Sean Washington were hooked up in a foot race. And Washington looked like he did the smart thing. He just got in front of Adams.
He had great position all the way on that play. Washington just was right in front of him and stayed with him. Adams kind of slowed down and was going to try to use the second burst of speed, I believe. But Washington just hung in there and didn't allow him to run through him.
Mike Adams, a big play receiver, so is Lavelle Pinckney. Pinckney is missing tonight's game for disciplinary reasons. It was a dorm incident.
Campus suspension, not a football suspension.
So he will miss tonight's game. And he usually is on that other side. Big play capabilities for Texas. Inside handoff, Brown, big hole at the 40. He needs a block. We'll get it. He gets three at the 20. Brown at the 10. Brown at the 5. And he's brought down from behind. Out. 48-yard run.
Well, we said he had speed and power up front of the show, Bill. He showed his speed and power there. Take a look at it. Trap play. Right guard Neal goes across, makes a great trap. Rice expecting pass on second and long. Texas crossing them up on second long. They've been running the ball off a lot of times. This time they broke it up the middle. And he showed you his power and speed there.
First and goal to go for Texas.
Some tight end offense now.
And a good tackle and a good run by Anthony Holmes as he was able to wiggle free inside the 5 to about the 3-yard line. It looked like Holmes would be called for a loss on the play.
Of course, Seymour had a good shot at him there at about the 5-yard line and just missed the tackle. You got to tackle. You got to wrap your arms around strong back. Watch right there. Seymour had a chance. Hit his ankle. Let him get away, and he lunges forward to pick up the yardage.
Good shot. Gerald Crawford is in that backfield now, along with Jackson. Morenz has a man open. Touchdown, Texas! The tight end, Jimmy Hakes. First touchdown reception of the season for Jimmy Hakes, the 6'5 junior out of Kerrville. Good play action by the Longhorns.
Come out to what they call the stacked eye formation.
Chad Lucas will hold for Scott Zaretti. Extra point is up and good. And the Texas Longhorns get on the board. That is only the first touchdown in the first quarter this season for Texas. 6:06 left to play. The Horns have the lead. Welcome back to Memorial Stadium. The Texas Longhorns moving down the field rather abruptly, and Bill Brown with a good run on that possession. But it was the Longhorns going in to lead it 7-3. Look at this again, Ed.
Well, play action pass, of course, you can see right back into the end zone, and he does come down inside the hash mark. Mitchell's right on top of it. As he hands up for the touchdown, that's only Hakes' fourth catch there. There's a play action fake with three backs in the backfield there. Taking his choice of either one. Picked up Hakes. Quarterback reaction. Moran says, all right, about time. Yeah.
Well, he's a youngster who's taking 15 hours in school, and he says, if you combine John Makovic's offense, I think I'm taking 21 hours.
Well,
it has to be tough for a young man to be trying to assimilate all this information.
Well, Bill, you know, obviously this is a young freshman redshirted quarterback who's planning about his fourth college football game.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he's learning on the go and learning on the run and learning in the heat of competition. He had the luxury of sitting here and sitting around and watching someone else make the mistakes and do the things. He's got to get in there and learn how to read coverages and see all the different things, adjust each week. There's a scoring drive. It took him six plays to go 78 yards in 2 minutes and 18 seconds. So far in this ball game, it's been a game of big plays by both teams.
Well, Zaretti will be kicking off for Texas. And you need to keep an eye on Jimmy Lee, because he is as dangerous as Adams is on the reversal. Lee, a junior out of San Antonio, and he can get that ball back in a hurry also. He's averaging about 21 yards a return, and he has a 47-yard kickoff return this year. So far in total offense, Texas with 111 yards, Rice with 68. So it looks like the offenses are off and running tonight here in the first quarter.
Looks like an offensive football game.
Zaretti gets a foot in it. Lee will have a return at about the five. Reverse. That's exactly. We called his number three or four times on special teams at Louisville last week. And, boy, you can count on him to be in on a lot of tackles.
Well, I wasn't even looking at Howard, because I was looking at the wall over here. If Howard doesn't make that tackle, they had the wall set up over here on the left side. I was looking ahead, thought they was going to take that down the sideline for about 40 or 50 yards. They really had it set up on a return to the Longhorn bench.
That was Bo Ballas on the return on the reverse.
Round Rock, Texas, sophomore safety.
So the Owls now deep in their own territory. Jimmy Lee goes in motion. Yancey Edmonds with a handoff. Big number 74 out front, blocking across the 10 to about the 12. Boy, Jimmy Golden was bearing right down on the Texas defensive back. Robert Reed made the tackle.
Bill, that was the first trick play we've seen this evening, but I have a feeling that won't be the last of the trick plays we're going to see. I have a feeling the Owls are just going to go all out in this ball game and pull all the strings, all the stops. That one was really set up. They were Texas was very fortunate. Howard made that saving tackle.
Second down, the Owls need three. Yancey Edmonds over the right side. Big hole, and he squirms free for about five, and a Rice first down. Winfred Tubbs on the tackle. Let's go down to the field, Bill Land.
Thanks, Bill. And, you know, it isn't often that a team like Texas needs a confidence boost, but I think they did tonight. They were a little shaky when Rice had the ball, was moving in. They got a boost defensively, which they certainly needed when they held him for a field goal. And then to answer with a quick big play and a touchdown, it's all grins again on the Texas sideline. But it's something that they needed that in the other years that might not have been the case.
All right, first and 10, Rice. Ball on the 16-yard line.
Texas blitzing, Bill.
Well, the Owls picked it up momentarily. Emmanuel can't go anywhere, and they've got him trapped in the backfield.
Are you surprised to see Texas blitzing so much this early in this ball game? Here comes a blitz. You can see him come back. Emmanuel back in the pocket. See all the orange jerseys closing in on him. No one was open downfield. Good coverage downfield. And you see all the orange jerseys closing in on top of him.
I tell you, Jason Reeves was there. Stoney Clark. Reeves, a sophomore from Austin, was in on some big plays in Louisville last week as he started playing more. Brackens, of course, is a freshman. Clark is a sophomore. This is an awfully young Texas defense. And this on-the-job training is tough to get when you play the caliber of people that Texas has played this season. Emmanuel, second down, needs 11. And the pass was incomplete, intended for Herschel Crowe.
Well, I think maybe that blitz, and he got sacked a little bit. That was not a very well-thrown ball there. He just didn't get planted. The receiver was open, but it was not very well-thrown. Last year in 92, he was the fourth best in the nation with pass efficiency, 92%.
Third down, Rice. Ball on the 17. Four wide receivers for the Owls. Airing it out again. Costin at the 50, and he's got it. Byron Costin on the identical play that they were able to complete just a few series ago. And Emmanuel drops a beautiful pass right into the outstretched arms of Costin.
Boy, he really did. He comes back, sets up, and delivers it. And Texas had deep people back there. They just didn't react and move to the ball. He laid that over the top. That's incredible. What a great throw this is. Right over the top of the defensive back, the other back throw. Bryant Westbrook was planting him underneath. That was just a great pass. That's almost impossible to stop if you throw it that well.
You think of Emmanuel as a runner, but he has a good arm, as we have seen now on several occasions.
No backs remaining in the backfield.
Emmanuel again going down the middle. And that was Ed Howard, his big rangy 6'4 receiver out of Willis. That's the type, if you split that zone, you've got a touchdown.
That's exactly what he was trying to do. They took the back out of the backfield. He had no remaining backs. They were trying to spread the field. Take a look at it. You can see him spreading the field, but he's looking for the zone coverage right there, and he almost had him. Ball just missed his fingertips. Could have been another big play for Rice. Looks like we're going to see a lot of big plays in this ballgame.
Emmanuel is 2 for 5 here in the first quarter, 3:40 left to play, but both of his completions have been big plays. He has 80 yards.
No back remaining again, Bill.
Emmanuel is hurried on the play. Yancey Edmonds can't bring it in. He really had a big rush by Thomas Baskin on the play. He was all over it.
Well, that's the problem with taking his backside. He can't have anybody to help him. Now that defensive line can pretty well tee off because they know the only runner is Emmanuel. Baskin just got around the junior, Mike Eklund. Baskin just using his strength and size. Put a lot of pressure on Emmanuel. Of course, that's the best pass defense there is if you can get on top of that quarterback. Now Texas is going to blitz. They're going to be a man-to-man. Just looks like the way they're lining up.
Third down and 10 for Rice.
They're coming after him now. He gets through the middle. I was just going to say that.
Sneak him out.
Starting to say it to you, Bill. If he could come up that middle, because the hole was there. They were up there lined up in the blitz situation. Manuel takes it all the way for the touchdown. We talked about confidence builders.
And when Texas lined up defensively, Emmanuel made a signal with his left hand right before the snap. Was that to tell
his team what he was going to do?
Well, he had something up his sleeve. I'm sure he did that to maybe even throw the Longhorns off a little bit. He knew in his mind where he wanted to go because that was a natural hole that was there.
4-4 speed for Emmanuel. Johnny Bagwell with the extra point. And boy, we've got fireworks at Memorial Stadium here tonight. We still have 3:27 left to play in the first quarter. And the Rice Owls lead it 10-7. 17 points scored here in the first quarter with 3:27 left to play. And that Rice drive covered 94 yards. And Bert Emmanuel had a majority of that.
Looked like a rock concert on the sideline over there. There he is, just right up the middle. He saw the natural hole where they didn't have someone in the gap. All it took was one missed tackle in there, and Emmanuel took it all the way to the end zone.
Ed, how can you not have someone on him?
Well, someone busted an assignment, Bill. When you have a blitz going like this, you always have someone assigned for sure. It might have been Tubbs that's responsible because he looks like he's trying to get back into play here because immediately he races right over to where the play is going. It really had to be a missed assignment because you don't draw any defense up where you don't have every gap controlled, especially when you're bringing an all-out blitz the way they were. They were lined up man-to-man, bump and run, and bringing everybody else that didn't have a man. So I'm sure someone in the Texas defensive lineup missed their assignment.
Well, we've had the fourth kickoff here so far in the first period. And Mike Adams is back at his goal line. So much speed on this field tonight, you're liable to see a lot of big plays before this game is over. Bagwell will get a foot into it. It's going to be short at about the 8-yard line for Adams.
Natural holes.
Got a natural hole. Oh, and he cut left. If he'd gone right up the sideline, he might still be running as he's brought down at the 35-yard line by Bobby Dixon. Well, the Texas Longhorns thought they had the Owls back deep, and they did for a while, a 94-yard drive.
Well, 94 yards on 8 plays. Of course, Emmanuel's 50-yard touchdown run was a big thing. Of course, there's the defensive coaches over on the sideline talking to the players, trying to make the adjustments to what's going on. Bobby Jack Wright over there. Leon Fuller, the offensive coordinator.
This is an experienced staff that John McAvick has brought to the 40 acres. A lot of good football coaches on both sides of the field here tonight.
Yeah, I'm surprised, Bill. I see Texas blitz him. And now I know what they're thinking is the one way you take away the option play is to get penetration and get your lineman upfield through the gaps. But so far, Rice has kind of countered that by not running the option. They've been running straight plays at him, the running plays with Edmonds. They're going back and setting up and throwing deep. They've got a problem with the clock. That's why the officials over on the sideline now trying to figure that out. But so far, Rice hasn't used the option, and the defense of Texas has been attempting to use his group primarily to stop the option play where you get penetration and force Emmanuel to go a little deeper in the backfield. But we haven't seen the option yet.
Let's go down on the field now. Bill Lamb, what's up?
Well, you guys are talking about speed, and there's Bert Emmanuel. He's got the headset on talking to Mike Heimerdinger, the offensive coordinator, up in the booth. And he unofficially, but by the Rice people, has been timed at 4.28 in the 40. Now, Ed, everyone says he wouldn't play quarterback in the NFL. Where do you think he's best suited professionally?
Well, the professional people, their thought will be to make him a wide receiver. My own personal opinion of seeing Emmanuel is I think he'll be a good defensive back in the pros because he has closing speed, he has quickness. He understands some pretty good thoughts about the passing game, having played quarterback. So my personal preference would see him have a chance maybe. On the other hand, what a quarterback he could be in the Canadian League with that wide field and the ability to run all over the ballpark.
I was going to say he looks to me like a young Warren Moon. You know, Moon used to be able to run pretty fast back when he was playing at Washington and then the Canadian League, and then he got bigger as he played more. So Texas has the ball now. And Bill Brown is really stacked up by Brenton Goins, the left tackle. Goins, a sophomore out of Katy. He was right there.
You know, a lot of pursuit by the Rice Owls. This is some kind of a trap counter. They're running to the short side. You can see him pull that tackle, trying to get him out in front of the play. Whetstone getting him a backside tackle, trying to play him and get him around through there. Of course, there's Goins. He's from Katy, Texas. 6'4". Rice is a little bigger than they've been in the past, Bill. They've got a little more size on the offensive and defensive line.
Jackson and Brown, dual backs.
Rice is blitzing. Look out. They got two. They split the blitz.
Brown, 50. 30-yard line, trying to cut it up to the 22-yard line. And again, a blitz by Rice. And again, the blitz is burned.
Well, both teams gambling defensively, and both teams have been burned. Once you split, all you need is one block to get up through there on a blitz. If someone doesn't control the gap, looks there. You see, missed tackle. And Nathan Bennett, now just off to the races. Someone has to catch him from behind or from the side. Take a look. Jeff Sowles makes the play, but look at the hole. They had a trap play called where they brought the tackle across to make the trap.
Joe Phillips with a great block up front.
Once he made that block, Sowles has to come from the other side to make the tackle.
First and 10, 21-yard line, and Phil Brown on reverse. 100. There's Jackson handing it off on the reverse play. Adams needs a block inside the 10, and he's brought down at the 10-yard line. Razzle, dazzle on both sides of the ball. Nathan Bennett on the tackle for Rice. And Adams, I'll tell you what, when you talk about a passing gear, he can put it in one.
Evidently, the wishbone and beer has been put into dry dock, Bill. There's a reverse. You can see the handoff to Adams with his great speed coming around the side. Tries to use his blocker, trying to get the big offensive lineman out in front of him. Says, get going, Phillips. Get down there and make a play. Don't wait for me. I'll outrun you. That's one of the problems you have a lot of times with good plays. Those linemen are waiting for the runners, and the runners, of course, can run right up their backs.
First and 10 at the 10. Maybe it's first and goal, and there's a handoff to Roderick Walker. Left side, it's a foot race to the goal line, and Rice wins it at about the 4. I'll tell you, Jeff Sowles showed me some good closing speed. I thought that Walker might be able to get inside the flag.
Well, his father was a fine professional defensive back in the NFL. Let's look at the play. Again, you can see Phillip pulling, leading the play. Now, this time, Rice closed that hole down in there. A good adjustment by Walker to turn and take it to the outside and almost put it in the end zone. Sal's dad played with the New York Jets and the Houston Oilers.
Jackson and Crawford in the backfield for Texas. 3 yards for a touchdown. Morantz drills it. And it's touchdown, Texas. Justin McLemore. Justin McLemore, the junior out of Waxahachie. And Morantz showed me a lot of poise. He sat back in that pocket until McLemore was able to get open.
He waited. Finally, McLemore got inside of Washington. Delivered it the minute he got inside. Yeah, it would have been good in the pros, Washington, but he got 1 foot down in there, so it's good here.
That's all you have to do is get 1 foot down. That's the first touchdown reception this season for McLemore. Oh, we are seeing a lot of fireworks. Another point is added. We still have 1:27 left to play in the first quarter, and 23 points have already been scored in this game.
Well, we've had five possessions and four scores on the five possessions. He said, again, look at the key. Sitting in that rocking chair, looking right where he wants to go with it. The minute McLemore gets open, delivers the ball to him. McLemore, good size, 6'1", 178-pound junior. Got good hands.
He really does. That's the key to McLemore, great hands. We talk about so much about Adams and Pinckney on this team, but McLemore catches about everything coming his way. And the other youngster, the redshirt freshman on the other side, playing in place of Pinckney tonight, Matt Davis, has great hands too, a youngster out of Fort Worth. So a lot of receivers in this Longhorn camp.
Well, if both teams keep blitzing, we're going to see some scoring, Bill, because so far both teams have taken advantage of those blitzes.
You know, I thought it was ironic the Houston Cougars pulled off a big upset of Baylor today, and in their new defensive scheme of things, Ed, they decided to throw the blitz out. They played fairly a conservative defense.
I'm going to tell you what, Houston Oilers ought to go hire that guy. He took over Wednesday, and they changed that much defensively. The Oilers talk about their defensive. The man can change the defense that much in 2 days. He's got to be Superman.
That was a huge, huge upset in the Southwest Conference today. And the Owls trying to pull an upset here tonight. Texas, however, has a lot of firepower and leads it 14-10, and we still have 1:27 left to play. And with that young man back deep, Jimmy Lee, don't go away.
Yeah, he can turn right around and take it right back.
He is as explosive as they come. And Scott Zaretti will kick it off for Texas.
Penalty was assessed on the kickoff. He's kicking off from the 40-yard line instead of the 35-yard line. Rice was offsides on the extra point, so they assessed it here on the kickoff. He's kicking off from the 40, so he's making it in the end zone.
And that's exactly what he does. So the Owls will set up the offense on their own 20-yard line. And as we take a look at the scoring drive, 65 yards on 5 plays, and it only took 2 minutes. And I'll tell you what, these drives have covered a lot of yardage in a short period of time.
Well, each one of them has had a 40 and 50-yard play. When you get that 40 and 50-yard run or pass, whichever it might be, that really shortens the field down, because now you've only got to go a couple first downs, and you're in the end zone.
And Ed, take a look at the total yards.
See, and we're still in the first quarter.
That's right. Boy, I'll tell you.
338 yards of offense.
That would be a heck of a half, but it's a heck of a quarter.
At that rate, that's over 1,000 yards a game.
Yahtzee Edmonds, big hole at left guard, and he pounds it to the 25-yard line. Robert Reed, the first tackler to him. But again, great blocking up front by Chris Cooley, Mike Eklund, and Tom Hetherington. And that's a big offensive line for Rice.
And yes, the part about Bill, the left side of that offensive line, Cooley and Eklund, who they're running, the side they're running a lot at, are a sophomore and junior. They'll both be back. Bobby Gray, their right guard, is just a junior. So Rice put a pretty good football team together here.
Look out for Costin again. 4 wide receivers, nobody in the backfield. Costin is in for Edmonds.
Now this time they're not blitzing. They're going to play it safe.
Emmanuel has really hurt Texas. Big rush. Look at Emmanuel get away, and he gets back to about the line of scrimmage. Boy, I'll tell you what, Jason Reeves was able to wrap him up, but the horns were coming fast.
Well, that's going to be the whole key from Rice's standpoint. If they can block the big defensive line, they'll be able to do something. He's back in the pocket now. He avoids one. He avoids two. He avoids three. The fourth one finally gets him.
Tony Brackens, the freshman from Fairfield, was the first one to him. Brackens with 2 sacks this season.
The pace of this game, Bill, the defensive linemen better be alternating. They better be playing all 8 of their defensive linemen in this game. They're going to be tired in the fourth quarter.
Third down, and they need 6, and oh, boy. No, I don't think Herschel Crowe caught the ball. I think it's an incomplete pass. Crowe was wide open, and I think he saw all that AstroTurf in front of him, took his eye off the football, and dropped an easy first down.
Well, that was some...
So that's the end of the first quarter of play, and my goodness, we have seen some fireworks at Memorial Stadium. Stay with us. Texas 14 and Rice 10. Welcome back to Austin, where the Longhorns hope that tower is bathed in orange light tonight after this game, and that usually signals a Texas victory. And right now, the Longhorns leading Rice 14-10 as we have played one quarter, and Bert Emmanuel has had a lot to do.
Well, you can see the natural gap there on the play where he took it all the way into the end zone, 50-yard run for a touchdown. Longhorns were blitzing everybody, but they neglected to put someone in that gap. Emmanuel recognized it, took it to the end zone. And actually, this drive was stopped because the receiver dropped the pass. They're going to be forced to punt that. The receiver had the ball in his hands and would have had another first down for Rice.
Max Smythe, the umpire, was the closest one to tackling him. he was playing middle linebacker. Tucker Phillips averaging 37 yards a punt on 26 punts this season will go to the quick one.
Well, I think the punting game is definitely in Texas' favor.
Now, Mike Adams averages about 11 yards on his punt return. Has a 54-yarder against Syracuse. So Rice will have to cover. Low end-over-end kick. Adams has a little room and runs it out of bounds at about the 42. Nathan Bennett was breathing right down his neck.
Well, that was a good punt. He punted it to the left side, cut down the field for Adams to run to, and they had good coverage, and well done job by the punter.
We'll be covering the Texas band at halftime and all of the colorful ceremonies here at Memorial Stadium. They marched out on the field. They started at Bastrop and ended up on other side of Austin.
I thought there was 2,000 about there when I looked out there.
Shea Morenz is off to a great start tonight for Texas. And he'll throw on first down. Plenty of time for Morenz across the middle. McLemore, nifty move at the 40. Trying to get around a Rice defensive back. And McLemore run out of bounds in Rice territory. A 20-yard pass play by Texas. Bobby Dixon was trying to run him down.
Yeah, but look at that protection. Look at the look how much time he's got. He looked to the right side, looked to the left side, and he comes back. Finally, McLemore gets open underneath. And he runs to the sideline trying to outrun.
McLemore very active tonight with Lavelle Pinckney on the sidelines. McLemore already with a touchdown catch. He comes to the sideline. And the handoff. Roderick Walker gets inside the 30 to about the 28-yard line.
Well, they're doing a good job for that particular running play because these safeties have got to come across the field and get up there to give it the force. Defensive end comes upfield, they're running it underneath. If the defensive end closes it down, they're bouncing it to the outside. And then the safety has to come across. A long way for him to make the tackle.
High formation, and Curtis Jackson will dot the I. Jackson with a ball, right guard, big hole, runs into his own man, twists off, breaks the tackle, gets down to the 20-yard line. Oh, boy. Extra effort by Curtis Jackson. That's as determined a running as I have seen Jackson display all season.
Yeah, and right now they're making Rice miss some tackles. The backs are putting extra yardage. Again, it's just an isolated play with the late backer coming in there. There's a missed tackle there. There comes Bennett with a missed tackle. He bounces forward and picks up 6 extra yards on his own athletic ability.
A good block on that play by Gerald Crawford. Morenz looks right. He's going to air it out down the left side. McLemore is there. Good defense by Rice. Bobby Dixon had him covered all the way.
That's kind of interesting. The number of times that Texas has put the ball in the air on first down, Bill. And so far, they've been very successful coming back. If they don't complete it, to come back on second down and do a good job running the ball. Lee Bryant, sideline there, receiver coach. And a fine receiver coach, head coach at one stage of his career at Ohio University. There's your run again on second down.
And a handoff to Anthony Holmes. And a fumble on the
ball. Might have been fumble. I don't think they're going to give it to
him. I think he was down, Ed, as he got just about to the 17-yard line. A whole bunch of Owls getting up. Emmett Waldron getting up off the bottom of that pile.
That's going to be a key third down play here, Bill, from both standpoints. From Texas standpoint, they don't want to settle for a field goal. And Rice would like to hold them to a field goal, so they'd only be one touchdown behind. Big third down play here.
We'll see the yards rushing so far for Texas, trying to get the ground game going. Third down, Texas needs 6.
We've got time. Got plenty of time. That's the key.
It's complete.
Amazing when you get the time, how much better quarterback you are. Morenz back in the pocket now. Plenty of time. He looks downfield, comes off right now. Goes across to the Steve Bradley, the freshman tight end, 6'2", 224-pounder, who picks up the big first down. That's a big third down play for Texas.
They've been pretty successful with a twin tight end alignment. And that's what he has in there now is Anthony Holmes, the only running back behind him, 1st and 10, Texas. There it is to Holmes, looking for running room. He gets away from one. He's in the end zone. Touchdown, Texas. What a nifty move by Anthony Holmes. Looked like he might be brought down in the backfield, but he scampered in for 6.
Well, he made Nathan Bennett miss. And Bennett's not a small defensive back now. Bennett's a 6-foot, 190-pounder. And Holmes, of course, is 5'10", and is kind of the short fire plug type running back. Take a look at it now. I watched Bennett come up right there and misses a tackle. When you miss a tackle, that close to the goal line, good back will put it into the end zone. Holmes doing a good job.
his first touchdown of the season on that 6-yard touchdown run, and Zaretti will attempt to add the extra point. And the cannon tells you that it's good. And the Longhorns go 58 yards on that play and lead it now 21-10 with 12:21 left in the second quarter. 21-10, Texas leading the Rice Owls. A lot of offense so far in this Southwest Conference opener for both teams.
Seen a little bit of everything, haven't we, Bill? Passing game, running game, trick plays.
I think before the game, Shea Morris said we need to find an identity, and it looks like they're relying on their rushing game tonight.
Well, the running game has done well for them, and obviously here's a touchdown by Holmes. They bet it missing the backfield. He took it in the end zone. They're also going to give credit to the fact that offensive line is doing a great job both run blocking and pass protection. Of course, this is a run blocking play, and you can see the white jerseys of Rice push back off that line of scrimmage. They're controlling the line of scrimmage, and Rice, when Texas is forced to pass, is really not even getting any pressure on Morenz. And Morenz is a good enough quarterback, as most quarterbacks are. If they get time, you're going to get someone open.
Now, Holmes is a youngster, sophomore out of San Antonio, and you like the way that he makes people miss him. Not just one man can bring him down, and they've had Jackson and Brown and Holmes and Crawford and Walker, and he has utilized five backs so far here tonight.
And all three have made Rice defensive players miss tackles.
Texas now with 189 yards rushing and 45 yards passing, and the passing has been effective down near the goal line for Texas. 234 total yards for the Longhorns.
Well, Texas has scored the last three possessions. They've scored touchdowns.
21-10. Zaretti will kick it off. Jimmy Lee at his goal line. And he runs right in to a Longhorn at about the 12-yard line. Robert Crenshaw on the tackle.
Well, Brian Poole, the special teams coach, is going to have to be awful proud of the special teams for Texas so far this evening.
That's as good a job of covering Lee I've seen all season.
Yes, that's an excellent job. An excellent job on that reverse down there. That reverse had good potential. They've been solid all year on their special teams, though.
All right, let's see what Rice can do to try to get some momentum, get back into this game again. No backs in the backfield. Edmonds comes wide to the right. Quarterback draw. Emmanuel, he's got some territory to run across the 20 to about the 23-yard line. Winfred Tubbs was the first Longhorn to him, but a nice gain on the play for Emmanuel.
Well, he just goes back here just looking for daylight. He's looking for daylight, and he can find it. He knows he doesn't have any backs behind him, so the linebackers, the defensive secondary, have to be spread out in the coverage. And with his running ability, he's just like having another good running back in your backfield.
Tubbs really has to be on the lookout, doesn't he? That's a lot of pressure on your middle linebacker.
Well, you've got to spread out, so you've got to cover all those receivers. He can still throw the football to them. See, right now, they got no backs. Of course, you've got five potential receivers.
Emmanuel looking for the draw again. He's got it. 30-yard line to about the 35-yard line. And that's enough for a Rice first down. Jason Reeves, Winfred Tubbs on the tackle for Texas. But again, the quickness of Bert Emmanuel makes the play for Rice.
Well, he's tying up by this formation. What they're doing, Bill, is tying up 5 and 6 Texas defensive players in coverage. Regardless of how you want to space them and whether you want to call them defensive backs or linebackers or nickel or dime or whatever all the fancy words you're using, he's tying up a lot of defensive personnel. You have to cover them. They are eligible receivers.
Emmanuel, 75 yards rushing here in the first half on 6 carries. Of course, the big one, that 50-yarder for a touchdown. Yancey Edmonds over left guard. That's good pursuit by Texas. Winfred Tubbs went right to the ball.
Don't think they have much success running east and west. They've got to run north and south. Edmonds, if they're going to run him, I think they've got to run straight ahead. I think they can have some success that way. But Texas has great But take a look now. It was a look at Tony. Look at Tony Brackens playing on the nose guard. Go right down the line and get it on the play. That's a freshman, 6 foot four, 230-pound freshman. Brackens did a great job on that play. Gave him about one for Rice. Yancey Edmonds in motion. Manuel looks, wants to run, cuts it up across the 40 to about the 42-yard line. Good pursuit. Van Malone was there for Texas. And it looks like we've got a timeout on the field. A Texas player down. Take another look.
Well, he's back. Look around. I think he really wanted to pass the ball this time. I don't think this was a designated running play for him. No one was open. He then found daylight and ran the ball.
Looks like Jason Reeves, number 88, the sophomore from Austin, is down. He's had a good game so far for the Longhorns.
Yeah, he just come back off of being injured, didn't he?
Yep. We'll take a break. 10:23 left to play in the first half. It's Texas 21 and Rice 10. 10:23 left to play in the first half. As you look at this crowd here at Memorial Stadium, the Southwest Conference opener for Texas and Rice. And, of course, the Rice Owls have not defeated Texas in 27 years. Trying to do it tonight, but the Horns are trying to get one in the win column. And it's good to see Jason Reeves walking off under his own power.
Looks like he's okay. No, charge rushing?
Yeah, look at Emmanuel, 81 of the 115. In fact, his total offense has been incredible so far. He's passed for 80 yards, and he's rushed for 81.
Yeah, he's a great athlete, Bill. Well, he may be the best athlete come out of Rice University since King Hill. King Hill played football and basketball and golf. And, of course, had the opportunity. He was drafted by the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Good baseball player.
Sure.
Yep. All right, third down. The Owls need three to keep this drive alive.
Got a good roll. Now he can run it for the first down.
Well, he's going to pass instead. He's gone. Oh, I'll tell you what, Ed Howard was wide open, and he took his eye off the football at the last minute, and it falls incomplete. Ed Howard was off to the races, and he knew it, and he did not secure the ball.
Well, he tried to run before he caught the ball. Now, Daniel Conran picked up the first down, but he's wide open, took his eyes off the ball, and looked for the defensive back. When you do that, you know, watch him look to his left right away without catching the football. Looking for the hit, that's what intimidation does for you. That's what a little intimidation does for you right there. Defensive backs hitting him. You know, players got to learn it. You're going to get hit anyway most of the time.
Tucker Phillips inside his 30-yard line. There's Mike Adams back.
He ain't going to make it. Texas is ready for it.
Yeah. The little fake didn't work. The Longhorns smelled it out. And there is that Robert Crenshaw again, the special teams demon. Crenshaw and Brian Howard, it seems like they make every other big play. I'll tell you, it was a big play there, too.
Bill, that drop pass may have been the biggest play in this football game. Texas was there. They were ready. Drop pass, though, it may have been the biggest play in this football game thus far. This gives Texas the opportunity right now to widen this gap. If Howard had caught the ball, Rice would have been in the scoring area.
Jim Bob Evans, number 52, would not be fooled. And let's see now if Texas can take it in at the 42. Lawrence trying to get it all at once. He's got a receiver wide open across the middle, and he can't get it to him.
Defensive back Nathan Bennett fell down. He fell down on a 15-yard line.
Eric Jackson looked like he'd come out early for practice.
He walks it in if he catches it, because Bennett fell down. The defensive back, there's no one anywhere near him. You'll see the defensive back had fallen down. You can't see him in the picture. He's even behind him.
Look at Morenz.
Morenz knows it.
Yep. That's one of those, if you have a chance to look at your man that wide open, you just lob it up.
Well, let's see if they run again here now on second down and long after an incomplete pass.
And Brown again taking it around the left side inside the 40, 35, down to the 30, the 25-yard line. 15-yard run by Phil Brown, another Texas first down. Well, he is picking them up and laying them down tonight. Phil Brown, 118
18 yards rushing already before Corey Seymour can bring him down.
This is a draw again, delayed draw out of it. And Bennett with another miss. Nathan Bennett just having a bad night. He's really, and I think the Bryce Owls will probably replace him in the lineup right now. Poor Nathan's just struggling right now.
Bill Brown, we talked about it at the top of the show. We had a feeling they were going to get him the football, and they have done it. There's play action. Got a receiver wide open. That's his big tight end again, down at about the 18-yard line. Good play action fake. And Steve Bradley has been a big part of the Texas offense. That's his second reception on the night, so the freshman is seeing a lot of action. Bob Dixon on the tackle.
Good mixture of the play calling by the offensive coordinator of the Texas Longhorns. Dean Dahlquist is doing a good job mixing the plays. He's got Rice really off balance now.
A lot of blitzing in the first quarter, but it looks like both defenses now have settled in to a little more conservative mode.
Both of them got burnt pretty badly.
That's McLemore in motion. Lorenz wants to pass. Going to throw it on the screen pass. He's got Adams, and he was trying to get free. Got to about the 12-yard line. Jeffrey Mercer was down there for Rice. Also, Sean Washington.
That's one of the new plays that come off the run and shoot attack, Bill. That screen where they're bringing people back from the outside in. It's almost like a middle screen. Take a look now. The outside receivers kind of see the lineman coming down, seem trying to catch the ball, coming underneath that wall of blockers. Teams just taking that off the run and shoot attack. And that's one of the real new plays that's come back into football the last couple of years.
We have an injury update on Jason Reeves, and let's go down to Bill Lamb.
Thanks, Bill. Jason Reeves is going to be all right. Questionable whether or not he'll return this evening. He's got a pinched nerve in his neck. They put some ice and wrapped it in there. Might see him in the second half. We'll let you know.
All right, Bill, thank you. Right now, the officials are going to walk something off against Rice here. There was a flag on the play.
I think they were trying to decide whether the play gained more yardage or whether the penalty would give him more yards.
Holding! On the defense, first down.
Well, I'm definitely holding on the defense is a first down for Texas. And now it's first and goal for the Longhorns at the Rice 8-yard line.
Well, they had a first down either way. Probably not about one more yard with the penalty. They were holding. They didn't do a very good job of holding. They made a completion on that play.
Well, Texas has done a good job of play action down close to the goal line. Let's see. Bill Brown, the lone back in the backfield. First and goal for the Horns. 8:14 left in the first period. Brown will take it right side, looking for a block. He's got it at the five. Touchdown, Texas. I'll tell you what, the right side of that Texas offensive line, Clint Elliott at center, Dan Neal, Blake Brockemeyer. They threw some big bruising blocks, and Phil Brown took it home.
Well, two tight ends, two wide receivers, very difficult to get force up on the corner. And Texas doing a good job of getting those linemen out in front. When you get those linemen out in front, Troy Reamer leading the play. A small defensive back has to come up and force, and it's very difficult to do it. If they don't get penetration, they're going to make those plays on you.
125 yards rushing for Phil Brown, and Zeretti kicks it through. So the Rice Owls took an early lead in the first period, but the Longhorns have come storming back, and with 8:05 left to play in the first half, it's Texas 28 and Rice 10.
Welcome back to Austin, Texas at Memorial Stadium. It's halftime, the Southwest Conference opener in league play, and the Texas Longhorns up by a comfortable 18 points, 35-17. Texas with a 35-17 halftime lead here at Memorial Stadium in Austin, Texas. Longhorns on top by 18 over the Rice Owls. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Bill Land, and glad to have you aboard with us here. We trust that the bulk of our viewers, Rice and Texas fans, on this special order sports presentation saw a lot of what happened with your ball clubs last week. Iowa State falling to Rice, and of course, Texas losing Louisville. We want to catch up, though, on what happened elsewhere in Southwest Conference. Let's take a look.
We'll first stop in Waco, where the game of the day took place between the Baylor Bears and the Texas Tech Red Raiders. This game was an offensive masterpiece as both teams marched up and down the field at will. With the Red Raiders up 9-0 in the second quarter, J.J. Joe found Ben Bronson at the end of this 36-yard pass to bring the Bears to within 2 at the half. Big plays highlighted the third quarter for both teams. After Tech pushed the margin to 9, Baylor's pitch-catch tandem of Joe and Bronson connected again. This time for 44 yards, and the Bears were again down by 2. Then it was the Red Raiders' turn. Byron Bam Morris took this handoff from Hall and made like Earl Campbell, breaking tackles en route to the end zone. For the day, Morris rushed for 174 yards, his sixth consecutive 100-yard game. But Tech turnovers proved to be the difference in this contest, as on the final drive, Hall is stripped by Charles Horton, and the Bears recover to win their third game. Kim Helton and the Houston Cougars had a non-conference date in Ann Arbor against 8th-ranked Michigan. Redshirt freshman Chuck Clements was thrown to the Wolverines in place of Jimmy Klingler and fared pretty well, completing 25 of his 40 passes for 276 yards and 3 touchdowns. Lamar Smith ran the ball with authority, but the Rose Bowl champs proved to be too much at home for the young Houston Cougars. Finally, in Fort Worth, it was the Battle of the Metroplex as TCU hosted SMU. Redshirt freshman Ramon Flanagan got his first career start at quarterback and opened the scoring with his one-yard run. In the second half, with the Ponies up by 1, Flanagan called his own number again, and he was off to the races. 50 yards later, he was caught, but that set up another Pony touchdown and an 8-point lead. SMU extended its lead to 15 on this 42-yard bomb from Flanagan to Brian Berry and made it hold up for a 21-15 victory and bragging rights for 93.
And the Southwest Conference Player of the Week honors for this past week go to J.J. Joe, the outstanding quarterback of the Baylor Bears, 14 of 17, 254 yards and 2 touchdowns, 5th in the nation in passing efficiency. He is an outstanding player. Let's take a look at what happens score-wise around the country today. A lot of college football action going on, and we'll take a look at some of the scores that might interest you. In the Southwest Conference, A&M winning at Tech 31-6. SMU and Missouri fight to a 10-10 tie in Columbia. Baylor upended by Houston in the Dome, 24-3. Oklahoma State hangs on for a 27-22 victory over the TCU Horned Frogs. Florida State, are they awesome or what? 51-0 over Georgia Tech, gearing up for Miami. And Iowa falls to Michigan, the Big Ten, 24-7. Notre Dame in Stanford country wins 48-20 at the Farm. Oklahoma defeats Iowa State, 24-7 in Big 8 play. Arizona leading Southern Cal in the third period, 30-0 in the Pac-10. Alabama in the SEC in the third, a 17-0 leader over South Carolina. And Penn State hammering Maryland tonight. Penn State out of the Big Ten, plus one, over Maryland, 56-7 in the fourth period. When we come back, Bill Worrell and Biles will have a look at stats and highlights. Sam will try to visit with John Makovic, the Texas coach. Stay with us. Longhorns lead at the half, 35-17. Our score at halftime back here in Austin, Texas at Memorial Stadium. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Bill Lamb. Let's check out the stats and the highlights from the first half. It's been pretty much Texas. Here's Bill Worrell and Ed Biles.
And in the first possession for Texas, Shea Morentz, the quarterback, play action, and he finds Jimmy Hakes alone in the back of the end zone, and Texas gets on the scoreboard. But quarterback Bert Emanuel for Rice on the quarterback sneak, and Texas had spread out its defense to come on the blitz, and Emanuel kicked it into high gear, and Rice took the lead. But then Texas comes back again at the goal line, and Justin McLemore with a great catch kept the 1 foot in, and Texas is off to the races. Then they spread it around. Anthony Holmes, the running back, takes it around the left side and scores another Texas touchdown. Texas was doing it on the ground in the second quarter. Bill Brown, who had his biggest game so far this season, and there again was the replay of Holmes scoring again. And now possibly they will hand it. Well, we're going to see Holmes again.
And this time, Jackson takes it in. Now Texas, again. Now here's Phil Brown. I knew that he was somewhere on this reel. He has been just about every play, big play for Texas. So these are the halftime stats, and as you see, Texas an edge in first downs. Rice with the edge in passing, but look at the rushing yardage, and Phil Brown is rolling up his biggest game of the season, 153 yards for Phil, the longest coming on a 48-yard play, and it has been all Texas so far, over 300 yards total offense.
Well, a couple interesting stats there. Only one turnover in the first half of a ball game that had a lot of action, and also one penalty called on each team. And when you have a total of 567 yards of total offense with only one turnover and one penalty on each team, that's kind of an interesting half of football, Bill.
Well, you know, we've talked about it, Ed, the fact that Texas started with Colorado and then Syracuse and then Louisville, three highly ranked teams and high-powered teams with senior-laden teams. Now the Rice Owls come in here, Texas picking on somebody at least their own size.
Well, that's a conference ball game. You know, they're playing for the Cotton Bowl now. They're on the road to the Cotton Bowl. Every win in the conference can give them the opportunity. This is like starting a new season for all these teams in the Southwest Conference. Preseason is over.
I think what's encouraging, too, for John Makovic, this is the second 100 years of Texas football, and this is the 79th season of Southwest Conference play. Texas is 61-16-1 in league opening games, and that's an amazing record.
Yeah, that really is.
So Texas leading at 35-17, and the horns will be kicking off. Scott Zaretti on his 35-yard line, and Jimmy Lee really hasn't had a chance to do much here in tonight's game. Zaretti, look at that leg. He's got a south breeze behind him, but he's again 5 yards deep in the end zone.
Well, that special teams have played very well. Good coverage. Rice with the opportunity. They scored right before the half. If they could come back now and take this opening possession of the second half and put points on the board, it would certainly be a big boost for their confidence.
So Bert Emanuel trots in. He has rushed for 75 yards in the first half, and he's passed for 148 yards, but he has been sacked four times. And the Texas defense in the second quarter starting to put some pressure on Bert Emanuel. Yossi Edmonds in the backfield. Quick pass to Ed Howard, and he drops another one. I don't believe I've seen Rice drop this many passes all season, and Howard usually is very dependable.
Well, that's close to being called a fumble. This is going to be close to being called a fumble. Watch. He has the ball in his hands and turns. He's trying to run too soon. Right there, he's got his hand and starts turning and drops the football. He's just trying to make too many things happen too quickly.
Well, the Longhorns were right in Emmanuel's face. They're really getting a good rush.
It was a well-designed play, and Howard was wide open, and from the coaching standpoint, that drives you crazy. You get that wide open, he drops the ball.
Second down, Rice. Emmanuel again. Looks across the middle, has a receiver open. Went for Tubbs with the interception. Tubbs at the 30. Tubbs at the 25, and he runs out of bounds. Winfred Tubbs with his first interception of the season. And welcome back, Mr. Tubbs.
Oh, what a great drop, Bill. What a great drop on the zone coverage. Emmanuel never saw him. He was dropping deep. He was trying to go deep. His drop, he is back about 25, 30 yards and makes a break on the ball. Watch him close on the ball. Look at him dropping there. Closing on the ball. He's 25 yards downfield when he made that interception. And I'm going to tell you what, all the pro scouts sitting up there looking at him, he's one of the reasons they're here. They're going to now glamorize that type of play.
You're reading my mind. I said the pro scouts have to be drooling that a man that big can go back that deep in pass coverage.
Well, that's the question that they want answered. Can he play pass coverage? And he shows you right there that he can drop and get to the ball.
Cut his hand badly in an accident at the end of this summer. Severed some tendons in his hand, but he's okay now. There's Morenz going for all of it across the middle, and a great play defensively made by Sean Washington right at the goal line. It looked for a moment that Justin McLemore might have it.
Well,
Sean Washington, Houston Waltrip, is within. He needs to make one more interception and return it for 1 yard. He'll have the all-time interception return yardage for Rice. Did a good job of closing on that ball. Now, Texas, a poor first half after the incomplete pass, ran the ball on second down. Let's see if they do it. Let's see if Rice has adjusted to it.
There it is again. It's time to hand off to Roderick Walker. And he gets inside the 20 to about the 18. Nathan Bennett, Jeffrey Mercer on the tackle for Rice.
They still picked up close to 6 or 7 yards on that play. They've done this the entire ball game. And the Rice defense has to realize that they've been on second and long running the football. They picked up 6 yards.
Acklemore and Mike Adams, the wide receivers.
Now this is a two tight end where they have had success running the ball off the corners.
This time Lorenz will throw it into the end zone. He's got a receiver there. Good defense by Rice. Sowles, Jeff Sowles, you talked about him earlier. They had the big freshman, Steve Bradley. He's a rangy kid at 6'2", and he was open for a moment. Sowles closed in a hurry.
Well, Sowles just... Well, his daddy used to play. My coach's dad was a defensive secondary coach of the New York Jets. Dad posed on the ball that same way. Good play by Jeff Sowles, sophomore from Willow Ridge High School.
There's the young man, and
well, thank God he looks like more like his mother.
So the ball will be placed down by Chad Lucas at about the 26-yard line. Zaretti has got the good leg. Is he accurate? Yes. More offense for Texas. 13:51 gone in the third period, and the Longhorns get on the scoreboard one more time. It's Texas 38 and Rice 17. 38-17, Texas over Rice with 13:51 gone, and again, Texas takes the football and gets some points on the scoreboard. And tonight, Ed Biles, the loneliest man in the stadium is Dwayne Vosick, number 99 for Texas. He has not had to punt one time.
He should be the happiest man in the stadium. You know, team players say, hey, when I'm not working, that means my football team's doing something good.
But against high-powered opposition to start the season, Vosick had to punt the ball a lot, and he's number 10 in the nation in punting, so I'm sure he wanted to get in there tonight. But the way Texas has been able to move the football, and it's really something to see the explosiveness of this Texas offense when they get it in high gear.
Well, a lot of weapons, Bill. That, again, with the ability to run, ability to pass, what you have to have. You can't have a one-sided attack in today's football. You can't be strictly a running team or strictly a passing team.
Must feel like the Maytag repairman. Huh?
They won't have to wash that jersey this weekend, will they?
Another one of those big Texas punters. They had some huge ones down through the years. This kid really does have a good leg, but we haven't seen it tonight.
6'3", 250-pound punter.
Tell you what now, on this Texas defense, Zaretti, also on special teams, has been booming the ball into the end zone. So Jimmy Lee really hasn't had a chance to return anything.
That's a weapon in itself.
And, of course, with 25, Robert Crenshaw, and number 19, Brian Howard, they are demons on that Texas special teams. And even if you return it, you don't return it far. Zaretti, right through the end zone. You know, they moved it back to the 35, Ed, to try to get more returns. Now the way the kids are kicking it, maybe you ought to move it to the 30.
I think you'll see that in the future. I think you'll definitely see it in professional football next year. And usually what professional rules do along the game line, you soon see the college teams go to it shortly thereafter. This is one of the most exciting plays in football. And when you keep eliminating it, well, you don't get a chance to see it, obviously. And people enjoy seeing kickoff returns. Just playing base defense right now, four-man rush.
Yancey Edmonds starts right, turns left, and there's a Longhorn, Robert Reed, to meet him. Great pursuit down the line of scrimmage for Reed.
Well, again, Bill, this, all these linebackers making this play happens because the defensive line. Now watch the defensive line of Texas establish the line of scrimmage on the other side of the ball. See how they get knocking people down? Well, now those linebackers can close in. They don't have anything in front of them. They don't have anybody coming out into their lap. They're free to roll the ball and scrape into the holes.
Second down, Rice. Bert Emanuel looking out to the outside. Big rush by Texas. Tony Clark right in there. Nice little dump pass as he dumps it off to Jimmy Lee. And for the first time tonight, he has been able to involve his slot receiver, Lee. And that's usually his favorite target.
Well, that all developed because they lost containment on him. Once he got outside of containment, defensive linebacker has come up. See now, there's no one open now. Good coverage downfield. But when he breaks containment out here to the left, see, the secondary linebacker had to come up to keep Emanuel from running the ball. He just dumped it to Lee, and that was enough for the first down.
Westbrook took him out of bounds, and Rice has a first and 10. Big rush by Texas. Emanuel across the middle, has a receiver, and it's good for the completion. And a nice job by Emerson Allen to get open. Chris Carter brought him down, but another good game for Rice. Let's go down to the field now, Bill Land.
Thanks, Bill. You're talking about that Texas defense. Following the interception by Tubbs, one of the Texas defensive coaches came over, met with the other linebackers, including Tubbs, and said, hey, when Rice goes into that trips option, or trips offense with no backs, you guys have got to back off and loosen up a little bit. He's continuing to try to remind them when there's no backs, they're not going to be running the football. They've been edging up too much. One of the reasons they don't progress with the pass.
Well, there you see Tubbs talking it over with the defensive coaches on the sidelines.
And Malone's the one who was injured on that play coming off from the sideline there. A little shaken up. I think he's okay. And there were two defense. They ran into each other at the end of the play.
Chris Carter, the freshman, Van Malone, the senior.
Van Malone, the free safety and the strong safety, running into each other. See them right there as they're coming across. I watch them go across and they hit each other. Both of them hit each other. Malone hit Carter, both of them shaking up, and both of them, I believe, are going to be all right. They're coming off the field. I'm sure we'll see him back in.
That was a nice catch by Emerson Allen of Rice, sophomore out of Houston, as he went high and made a good catch. And Carter is another one of those talented freshmen I talked about in the first half that they have on the defense.
Westbrook's a freshman. Tony Brackens is a freshman.
Ryan Johnson. Off again, Costin over left guard. He's pulled down at about the 45-yard line. Thomas Baskin.
Amazing how the stadium has gone so quiet now. It's almost like you're just kind of everybody sitting back observing to see whether Rice can do anything. Texas comfortable with the game, comfortable in hand. What was a loud stadium is now just a watching stadium.
Well, they had so many big plays in the first half. Just about upstaged anything you can do now. Second down, you see, in 7 for Emanuel. Still very dangerous. Scrambling to the left, out of harm's way. He'll tuck it and run at about the 40-yard line. He's about 2 yards shy of the first down. And there's Brian Vosick and Winford Tubbs on the tackle for Texas. That Tubbs is everywhere tonight.
Take a look at the protection, and you can see they're collapsing the pocket right on top of Emanuel, but he gets to the outside. Now, that's where he really is dangerous once he escapes to the outside. Last 3 pass plays, he hadn't been able to stay in the pocket. He gets outside because of him. But right now, the defensive linemen for Texas are almost ignoring the run. They're just going after the quarterback in any way, shape, or form.
Well, good numbers on Burt. Third down, Rice needs 2 to keep the drive going. I've got a feeling they may be in 4-down territory anyway. Emanuel rolling right. He's got the first down, tucks it in, and he's down to about the 36-yard line. Good for a Rice first down. Tony Brackens turned him upside down. Winford Tubbs was also close to the ball.
Now that was similar to that play in the first half where he threw the ball and it was dropped where he had the first down. This time he decided to make it for him by himself. He knows he just needs short yardage, and he's looking. He also knows that if I can make the first down, I better make it for myself and not take a chance on someone dropping the football on me.
Well, he's got to be a tough kid as much as he handles the ball in that Rice offense.
I don't think there's any question about him being tough.
13 rushes tonight for 85 yards. So he's close to 100. Emanuel, little flare pass out to the outside, and Texas led that beautifully.
was able to corral one, and Haskell Waddy was right there.
Out of Willis.
So apparently the Texas players are okay, and they'll be back into the game shortly. As it's second down, Rice needs nine.
Well, here's his trips formation. Let's see if those linebackers drop deeper.
Emmanuel takes it to his tight end, Clemente Torres, and throws it behind him.
Yeah, Burton will be upset with himself. He knew he threw that one behind him, and Torres was momentarily open, and he just missed him with that one.
So much of that Rice offense last year was Trevor Cobb, and they were trying to adjust this year and make this man more a part of it, and he certainly has been tonight, but he needs some help.
Yeah, tonight he needs a little more help from that defense. Texas put up 38 points. Only 10 minutes to go here in the third quarter.
Yeah, I think 17 points by Rice is adequate. Going for more now. Third down, but nine needed. There you see how many times Rice has been able to convert on third down. Back, big rush by Texas. He eludes one tackler, directing traffic, and he's pulled out of bounds finally. And that looked like Brian Johnson, the young freshman out of Jersey Village. And my goodness, Ed, he ran Bert Emmanuel down from the side. And this is a kid that weighs 221 pounds.
Well, this time his receivers didn't do much help for him. None of them came back to get in. He's looking downfield. He's looking for help. But nobody does anything. Finally, Johnson closes in on him. And the sideline was a little help for Johnson. I don't think he's quite as fast as Emmanuel, Bill. It was a good play by Johnson.
This will be the second punt for Tucker Phillips. His first travel, 37 yards. That's his average. Trying to kick this one over Adam's head. Can Rice kill it on the one? No, it's in the end zone. Touchback, Texas.
Pretty good effort. They almost threw it back into the field of play.
47-yard punt for Phillips. 9:41 left to play in the third period. It's Texas 38 and Rice 17. Texas going for that double win tonight. Its first win of the season and a Southwest Conference win, which is awfully important to start the season. Let's check out the top 25 in the AP standings this season, and look at Florida State. They may be in a league of their own. We'll find out, because Florida State takes on Miami next weekend, and that usually is the showdown. And since they've moved the hash marks in, Bobby Bowden's field goal kicker may be able to get it through the uprights. If he does, Florida State should win that game.
They play Notre Dame later in the season too.
That's going to be a big one. And you see Notre Dame with a big win today at Stanford. And Alabama hanging right in there. Florida, Nebraska, Ohio State. Look at the Aggies now starting to move up again. A very convincing win, I thought, for RC and his troops today.
Yeah, I think Syracuse will move out of there next week. They got beat again today. They'll be out of there. I think they'll be out of the top 20.
And, of course, Louisville. We were awfully impressed with Howard Schnellenberger and his team, and they were winning tonight in Pittsburgh. And that you see the top 25.
Louisville will play West Virginia, I believe, next week. Should be a good ball game.
Shane Morantz at quarterback. Hand off, big hole over the left side, and stumbling forward is Phil Brown, and he almost stumbles forward to a first down. This is the worst field position, I think, for Texas tonight at the 20-yard line.
Yeah, just a draw play. Goes back. Big gaping opening hole, and again, the Texas offensive line, you can't give them enough credit this evening. Greener, Elmore, Elliott, Neal, Rockham are doing an outstanding job.
In handoff, second man through, and that's Curtis Jackson. And he pulls his way to the 39, good for a Texas first down.
Getting redundant with this, but take a look at Brock Amar on the right side of the offensive line. Look at Brock Amar set up, wrap those arms around. That's a pretty good hold he had there. got away with it, but when you're controlling the line of scrimmage, and he's so huge that the defensive player can't see him, can't get around him.
I tell you, Derek Rutherford is a good football player, too, so he and Brock Amar are having some duels out there on the outside. Jay Morenz will pass on first down, trying to set up a screen, giving up ground, and he throws it out in the flats and absolutely threw that one away.
Yeah, and got away with it. There was a receiver probably 10 yards downfield from that, but good judgment by Morenz of throwing the ball away.
Well, he's just a redshirt freshman, Shea Morenz, trying to learn this offense and progress in it. I thought Peter Gardere, for the most part, did a pretty good job last couple of years.
Fred Goldsmith was reminding the officials that there wasn't a receiver within 10 or 15 yards of that play on the sideline there.
Well, there was, about 10 yards. The numbers on Morenz tonight, two touchdowns.
You know, I think they just ought to throw that rule out. It's such a controversial rule.
They did in the NFL. He gets outside the tackle.
There's a takedown by Roderick Walker,
and a flag flew Texas 40-yard line.
This is a hold on Jimmy Hakes. He just absolutely did a takedown on Derek Rutherford. I mean, this was a big-time wrestling takedown. Take a look at Hakes, the tight end. Watch it to the left of your screen. You're going to see it out here. Sooner or later, you're going to see it right there. There's the takedown. He just flipped him over and put him down. Official saw it. That's his responsibility to watch that play. Good call. No question what that was.
Well, I think he was gambling, or maybe the official would not see it.
Holding. Offense. Repeat second down.
Well, you repeat the second down again, but this time Texas will need 20. Texas needs to get the ball to the 49-yard line.
Never see an outside play develop. Bill, I always watch the tight end because that's the key to the block. If the tight end gets the linebacker, the defensive man backing off the line of scrimmage, it'll be successful. If he doesn't, usually the defense will stop it. But that's why I knew who that hold was on right away.
He fakes the draw. Morenz wants to throw long. He's got Justin McLemore. Justin McLemore, Bobby Dixon saves the day for the Owls. Boy, what a night, Justin McLemore, and they aren't missing Lavelle Pinckney at all. This goes for 60 yards.
Boy, he got hit when he delivered that pass, too. He put it down and threw it up in the air. Justin McLemore is making his bid to be a starter, and I think it'd be awful hard to keep him out of that starting lineup next week because the performance he's put on. Take a look at the play action now. This is a play action. There's the fake. They've been running that play away.
Well, it didn't fool Goins.
Rolling out to the right. Texas threatening again.
Well, this is an impressive performance by Shea Morenz. Here's Phil Brown, right side, looking for a block. And he's down to about the 10-yard line. Good tackle by Jeff Sowles of Rice.
This is off the two tight end requests. They're getting that guard pulled out in front of him. Tackle Reamer. Well, that's a lot of bodies to get out in front of that running play. You get that backside guard, backside tackle leading that play. You got a defensive back that has to come up and make the tackle.
Holmes and Crawford in the backfield. A handoff goes to Holmes, and he's down to the 2-yard line. He might be the touchdown specialist on this Texas team.
Well, they got some good back. No question. Brown's good. Holmes is good. Walker's good. Jackson is good. We haven't seen much of Crawford this evening, but they're all good backs. And I believe that Rice defensive line is beginning to really wear down a little bit now, Bill.
First down and goal for Texas. The tight ends come in. The twin tight end set. John Fike comes in along with Steve Bradley. Gerald Crawford comes out of the game.
Rice is going to have some kind of breakthrough to hold them. They're just a little bit back on their heels now.
Hand off again to Holmes. Cuts left. Dives into the end zone. And it's a Texas touchdown. Well, the young man out of San Antonio came into tonight's game. He had not been in the end zone this season, and he's already scored twice. And he has carried three times for 36 yards. So a big night for Anthony Holmes. And he's just one of the stable of excellent running backs for Texas.
Well, he made a good decision there. The play was designed to go outside, and he knew he only needed 3 yards. When he saw it, he took it.
Well, points hits have been hard to come by for Texas this season, but not tonight. And it's Texas 45, Rice 17, with 6:25 left in the third quarter. Well, just a good old Southwest Conference whipping that Texas is putting on Rice, trying to make it 28 years in a row, and they're doing a good job of it, and just sheer power on this play.
Again, offensive lineman pulling out in front, but a good decision by Holmes here. He sees daylight, knows he just needs 3 yards. Ferguson, he turns it up, he can get it into the end zone. Pretty good drive by Texas that time.
Well, he dived up in the air and fell right down on Dan Neal, one of his big offensive linemen.
See Elmore pulling out the lead to play. See Elmore's pretty good block out there on Siles. And Holmes turns it up and takes it into the end zone.
Well, Texas goes 80 yards. It took only 7 plays. Second touchdown tonight for Anthony Holmes. And there's some happy horns here in Austin.
Well, they get to get ready now for Oklahoma next week. Of course, Rice is going to return home to play TCU. Well, they'll have to recover. This will be a little bit of a long ride back to Houston for the Rice Owls. They appeared to be confident. They were not tight yesterday when they came in here. They were, I don't think, in all of the stadium and all of the Longhorns, but they did perform like they anticipated performing.
Hey, this support tonight by Texas is a real tribute to the crowd and the school spirit here at the university. There's Zaretti again, and he sends Jimmy Lee deep into the end zone for the touchback. You know, not many 0-2-1 teams could come home to open the season and have 60,000 people on hand, and these Texas faithful have stayed behind their team.
We're going to get a chance to exploit your theory here, Bill, that Texas was offside. So I think they're going to give him a 5-yard penalty, make him kick off from the 30. So let's see whether the new rule that you and I proposed, they have to kick off the 30, whether we get a kickoff return or not.
Well, Ed, I think he can kick it into the end zone, but maybe not as deep. Jimmy Lee might be able to take it back. Now, John Makovic is going to talk to his special teams now that they have to move back 5 yards.
John Makovic is telling his teams they've got interesting statistics. Usually will show you that when a cover team has to cover the second time, they don't go down quite as fast and quite as hard. You're talking about two, basically, 60-yard sprints. They just had a 60-yard sprint. Now they got to come back and run another 60-yard sprint. John Makovic, well aware of the fact that don't let down on covering this kickoff. Sometimes you see kick returns or punt returns under those circumstances where the team just doesn't quite hustle as much as they have on the first one.
Well, the mob band, not quite as much to cheer about as the Texas band, but they're showing some good spirit here tonight. And the Owls hoping to break that long losing streak. But it may have to wait again until at least next year. And I don't know how easy that's going to be because this young Horns team may be getting better as each game goes on.
Well, Texas, they have maybe winning a battle on the football field, but the halftime show, even though Texas had 2,000 members in their band or whatever that number is, Rice captured the hearts of a lot of folks with the performance that they put on. The takeoff on the Aggies, and of course that was true to the heart of the Longhorn fans.
That was sure to gain popularity here. That really wasn't going out on a limb very much. All right, Zaretti will kick it off from his 30-yard line. Look at this boot. He gets it high and long, and Lee right at the goal line. Jimmy Lee way in back, and he's decked at the 15. And look who it is again, Mr. Brian Howard. What a special. He is my favorite player in the country because he's one of those, what do they call him, the old grunt players on the special teams. And I'll tell you what,
kamikaze. I'll tell you one thing. Well, 18 went down there pretty good, pretty good lick on the Rice player, old.
Yeah, but that Howard
Cody,
is everywhere.
Yeah, Cody Dar went down there, though. I'll tell you what, he made an awful good play. He opened up for Howard to make the tackle. He is. He looking breathing hard. That 260-yard sprints back to back.
Bert Emanuel now will set it up for Rice. Deep in its territory. Yancey Edmonds, just no place to run. I'll tell you what.
Yeah, run sideways against this Longhorn defense, Bill. You cannot run sideways.
That Winfred Tubbs is getting ready. Yeah, and I like your side of it, mister.
Well, yeah, that's probably a little more exciting than being up there in the booth.
You know, if you're Texas now, Ed, you've got to feel, really have a good feeling that Tubbs is coming along just about the time you play Oklahoma.
Well, I don't think there's any question that obviously his hands are getting better. He still has them wrapped pretty good, but the way he's played tonight, you can see he's got a lot more freedom, a lot more use of it. That bandage has been cut down a lot from last week. Well, next week's ball game against Oklahoma obviously will be a very big ball game from a season standpoint, but it won't have any effect on the Southwest Conference.
Ball at the 16-yard line, second down. Al still needs 10. Looking inside, shuttle pass to Jimmy Lee. Boy, was Emmanuel decked on that play, and guess who's there? Winfrey Tubbs. I don't even need a spotter right now. I'm just going to follow 44.
Well, that was a lot of action on the play, Bill. That was a play where he started like he was going to run a reverse, then he went around the other way, and then he ran the old shuffle pass up to Lee. Now watch Emmanuel starting out like he's going to the right. Now run a counter over to the left. Now here comes a shuffle pass in there to Lee. But looks like Texas had that scouted out pretty good.
I want to tell you too, folks, Lee has got a lot of moves, and he could not fake out the 250-pound Tubbs. And look at Brian Johnson.
Well, Emmanuel's taken a pretty good hit and a pretty good beating here most of the evening.
He really has. All right, the shotgun formation for Emmanuel, third down. Rice still needing a lot of yards for the first. Open field for Emmanuel. Look out from behind. He gets the ball off to Howard. Howard makes the catch and a flag on the play.
Well, they're going to call Emmanuel beyond the line of scrimmage or lineman downfield. They're probably going to call lineman downfield.
Looked like Pascal Waddy was shaken up on the play for Texas at the sideline.
Illegal lineman probably downfield on this play. Could have called either one. Quarterback beyond the line of scrimmage or legal lineman downfield. Hit both of them happen on that same play.
And it's also a loss of down. So the Rice Owls will have to punt. And they have only stopped Texas one time. That was on the first possession of the game.
They stopped them at the halftime with the clock. Halftime clock. Now's a dangerous time. Look out for Adams now, Bill. Third quarter, he's going to get the ball probably near midfield. This is one of the most dangerous times from a punting standpoint. You usually see that teams are behind punt returns. This is usually one of the better times that you'll see punt returns happen.
We talk about punt returns, and I think you can figure that Mike Adams will be there at the top for the rest of his career.
A&M's got a good one. That's
Aaron Glenn.
Aaron Glenn does a good job. He did a good job in the ball game today. Watched most of that ball game before it came out for the stadium. And Adams, of course, for Texas.
Well, Tucker Phillips will be back on his own 2-yard line.
Looks like Texas lined up to go after it, but I would think that they might have a return on them in this situation.
They're going after it, Ed, and he gets an end-over-end kick. Adams cannot field. He'll have to wait for it to bounce. Lets it go over his head, and Rice gets a good bounce inside the Texas 40-yard line. So that's a good kick by Tucker Phillips.
Excellent, excellent punt under those circumstances. I really thought that Texas might have the return on.
Well, here comes the offense for Texas again. Texas has not been stopped since the first possession of the game. They were stopped on downs. Then they scored the next five times in a row. Then came halftime. Then they scored a field goal and another touchdown. So Texas has been unstoppable tonight. All right, Eric Jackson will come wide to the left along with Adams. Roderick Walker and Gerald Crawford in the game. I formation. And a good spinning run by Walker for a gain of about 4. There was Emmett Waldron again, along with Jeffrey Mercer.
Four or five-yard run. It doesn't seem very interesting after all the excitement we've had all along the big plays.
Well, Texas piling it up on the ground. This is as good a performance of running the football as I seen the Texas team in a while. Jay Morenz will go to the air, almost intercepted. He was looking for that quick square in to Adams. And a good job, Larry Izzo came over with Bobby Dixon.
Yeah, Izzo did a good job of the drop underneath man in zone coverage and worked hard to get out there and kept his hand on the ball. Goldsmith says Izzo's the toughest player on his team. That's quite a compliment. Coach says a player is the toughest one on the team. That's quite a compliment.
Well, he's not very big. He weighs only 210 pounds. He's playing linebacker. But he is tough from the woodlands. And he's just a sophomore. Third down. Lawrence needs six. Across the middle, he's got Adams. I'll tell you what. He could have gone. Bobby Dixon made a heck of a tackle on that play, or Adams was headed for six.
Well, they did a great job. They read the blitz. Adams read the blitz, and Morenz read it. Takes a quick three-step drop, looking for Adams. Adams gets underneath the cornerback. Ball was placed up high. Good catch by Adams. That ball was a little tougher to catch than what it looked like at the beginning.
Ed, is this the coming out party for Shea Morenz tonight?
Well, I think it's a great opportunity for him to get a lot of confidence, for his team to get a lot of confidence in him.
Only the first reception tonight for Adams. Morenz play action pass, looking across the middle. He's got a receiver. Jackson.
Well, they've come close on that play all evening, haven't they?
He has been overthrown three times in a row, although that time he got his hands on the football.
Okay, that same play action off of I formation, play action. And he just missing for connecting with this and for another touchdown.
Junior out of Corpus Christi, I think maybe he should have had that.
Well, that would have been a great catch.
Morenz wanted him to have it. Listen, tonight, 11 of 21 for Shea, 147 yards, two touchdowns. Now, coming in, he had only one touchdown pass and six interceptions, so that's a big turnaround, and he has not thrown the INT tonight.
That's a big difference. There's that trap up the middle again.
And the play by Curtis Jackson. That's Brown and Nduque Kalu, the young freshman out of San Antonio, number one, makes the tackle.
Yeah, I think this is the reason that they'll give Oklahoma fits next week. Their passing game will create problems for Oklahoma. Right, look at the difference in rushing yardage, 284 to 131. They've doubled the rushing yardage against Rice.
Phil had to limp out of the game. 168 yards rushing on 12 carries for Phil Brown.
Well, wow.
Pretty good average, isn't it?
Not bad.
Going deep. Morenz's got Adams. He couldn't hold on to it. A good closing rush by Bobby Dixon. Adams was wide open. Goins really put a hit on Morenz. And Dixon was covering on the play.
Well, one thing Shea's going to have to learn on the long ball, Bill, he needs to deliver it a little bit sooner. He allows the defensive by throwing the ball, he waits too long, he gets hammered when he throws it, but he allows some of the defensive backs to recover and make plays. Dixon recovered and made this play because the ball had to take too long in the air to get there. He needed to get that ball out there just a little, deliver it a little bit quicker.
All right, this will be a 52-yard field goal attempt by Zaretti.
A little wind behind him, but not that much.
He's got the leg. It's gone. Oh, boy. Everybody is having a big night in orange tonight.
Well, you got momentum, you got it. Well, he tied his longest in his career. He had a 52-yarder.
Back in 92, the 92 season, and
he's already kicked. Now, in practice, they tell me that he's kicked 68 yarders. I'd like to see that. Well, it might be with the wind behind, but this is another 52-yarder that he has kicked under game conditions.
Well, he's all Southwest Conference last season, and boy, he had
Knew it. He knew it. As soon as he hit it, he knew it. Look at it. He knew as soon as he hit it.
Ed, that could have been good from 62 yards out.
All kickers have that feel. They've kicked that ball so many times from so many different positions. They know when they hit it and when they miss it.
He was a good pickup, junior college transfer last season for Texas. And the one thing that's always impressed me about the Longhorns, they've always had an excellent kicking game. You've got to have it to win in football.
Oh, there's no question. A
punter and a kicker are well worth their scholarship.
Boy, this I have to admit, was a surprise to me. I thought Texas might win, but not by this much. Now, this is the week you should have picked Texas by 2 touchdowns.
You're not even going to be any credit for telling you I thought Texas. Okay, Bill.
Well, you thought Texas last weekend, too.
Well, let's see what we do here on the return. No return.
Zaretti ought to be running out of leg pretty soon. He's had a bunch of kickoffs.
That gets you pumped up. He kicks a 52-yarder. Kickers are like everyone else. If they get pumped up and start going good, they're going to do things that you normally won't see them do.
Well, everybody giving him the high five on the sidelines. He has been a busy man. Nine kickoffs for Zaretti tonight. 9 kickoffs, plus a couple of field goals. So that's 11 times he's advanced on the ball, and it didn't take long again for Texas to get on the scoreboard.
Of course, that was equals his career high, 52-yard field goal.
Josh LaRocca, the new quarterback for Rice, the sophomore out of San Antonio, ball tipped. And it falls incomplete. So Bert Emanuel tonight is through for the evening after taking quite a beating.
Probably a pretty good decision by the Rice coaching staff. The game is obviously a little bit out of hand. Might as well give the sophomore quarterback some experience. Let's just take a chance on Emanuel getting beat up anymore. And right now, his Longhorn defensive linemen are having the day that they all love to have, where they can lay their ears back and go after the quarterback.
Very impressed with the performance by Bert Emanuel tonight. Just a little too much Texas defense, but he never quit. There's a pass out to Byron Costin, and a lot of times that happens when a new quarterback comes in the game. Not quite the same throw that Emanuel might make. Ball was thrown a little hard for Costin.
Yeah, he just needed to kind of take a little bit off of that and lob it out there, let the passer run under it. There wasn't anybody anywhere near him, but again, LaRocca's getting some game experience.
LaRocca started the first 2 games of the 92 season before he went out with a broken collarbone against Duke. He got a medical redshirt out of that season. He's got 3 seasons of eligibility remaining, and this is the future for Rice when Emanuel hangs him up at the end of this year. Got a good arm, but he's not as quick. He does manage to scramble, however, get across the 20, 25. Good run by LaRocca for a Rice first down across the 30-yard line. Trey Thomas brought him down, but after I said he didn't have as much speed, he showed me a little bit of maneuverability.
Well, when you're comparing his speed to Manuel, you'll know he doesn't have that type of speed. It looks like he's got good escapability here the way he maneuvers around here. And again, that pocket is continually collapsing on the Rice quarterback. Had a nice little move there, shows good judgment. He made Tubbs miss, so to speak. Tubbs went after him and took the bad angle.
Well, a good run by LaRocca makes it first and 10 for Rice, 2:32 and counting. Left to play in the third quarter. There's a nice run by Costin. He gets about 3, maybe 4. Brian Vosick brings him down, trips him up. Tell you one thing about Yancey Edmonds, only 5'8". You see a Rice player down now.
Jimmy Lee.
Edmonds is at 5'8", Costin 5'9". It's hard to see those little running backs.
Yeah, it is. Jimmy Lee looks like he's pointing to his right knee. Looked like when he went down. Of course, that's Tubbs. He's looking to the sideline to get the defensive calls for the next position. Now, of course, with an injured Rice player on the field, Tubbs is going to jog over to the sideline.
Now, Tubbs, a Butkus Award candidate. You see that protective device on his right arm. He cut a tendon and a muscle in his right wrist. He had a freak accident involving a window at his apartment earlier this year. And he just really, we saw him have an interception tonight where he was able to use his right hand for the first time this season. And as he comes along now, unfortunately for Winfred, I think he'd have had a chance to make some All-American teams. He still might be able to if he finishes with a rush.
Well, his big coming out party, of course, will be against Oklahoma, so to speak, how he plays against them. And then, of course, the Aggie game, I'm sure, will be on television, national television. Oh. Penalty flag on the play.
Ryan Vosick, the big sophomore out of Smithville, and he met Costin at the line of scrimmage.
I got a feeling this is not one of these new alignment offside penalties that you're going to see. Doesn't look like anybody's offside. Oh, boom, he got hit. Doesn't look like anybody moved offside. I think they're getting close calls on the alignment of their defensive linemen. That's something they've learned, I'm sure, from the NFL officials.
Here's another young man. It seems like outside of Tubbs, everybody we call out to you is a sophomore or a freshman on that Texas defense. Malone's a five-year senior. Tubbs is a senior. And Joey Ellis is a junior.
Well, Westbrook get a lot of playing time as a freshman. So he'll be ready to step in as a defensive back next year for him.
Offsides, Texas.
Well, they did jump that time, and they were offside that time.
Austin fumbles the football.
Won't matter.
Big scramble on down around the 22-yard line. Who's on the bottom?
Well, it didn't make any difference if Texas recovered because they'll come back, but if Rice recovers, it'll be a big addition to the play.
Like
Texas
that.
Was definitely offside. A change in quarterback, Cadence got Texas to jump. Now, if Rice could come up with this ball, they'd have it way down there.
Looks like Pascalwani may have it.
Well, it doesn't make any difference because if Texas gets it, the play will come back. But if Rice happens to come up with it, why? Who'd they give the ball to? They haven't made any decision.
They haven't decided yet.
Well.
Offside. Defense. Declined. Put down.
Obviously. The offside is obvious, but Rice recovered the fumble. So you see him jump. That's a change in quarterback's cadence. Difference in Emmanuel's cadence and Baroka.
Boy, what a block on that play by Bobby Gray, huh?
Good block. Good block. Now, there's the fumble, of course. Now, there's going to be a wild scramble down there, and Rice recovers it, puts it on, takes over the 21-yard line.
No, I think that was Eklund, number 68, who got the block on Tubbs and really opened it up for Byron Costin. Now the Owls at the 22-yard line. First and 10, 1:23 and counting, left to play in the third quarter. Texas way up on the scoreboard. Costin again on the left side. Norman Watkins on the tackle.
And again, Rice coaching staff, I think, showing good judgment. They're going back to really just basic plays. Giving LaRocca a chance to run some of the basic plays and plays that they've executed over and over and over rather than asking your backup quarterback to come in and do all the fancy things that would probably get him into trouble. Giving him a little confidence and giving the team a little confidence in him.
That's a tough customer right there, a junior out of Humble. Big rush by Texas, trying to set up the screen play, and oh boy, what a tackle by Tony Brackens. Another freshman, and look at the speed. That 230-pounder got back into that Rice backfield in a hurry.
Well, it just came around again. Cooley's a sophomore who's getting a good education tonight. They're coming around him on the corner up there. And, of course, the rookie couldn't get the pass off. He was trying to set up the screen, but your tackle's got to stay in there and make the blocks on the screen. Don't let him just come running upfield on you.
So it'll bring up third down, and the Owls need 20. Rice needs to get it down to the Texas 12-yard line.
That's the last play of the third quarter, Bill. I was going to say, that's one of the problems with the all wide receivers. You got short corners for those people to come up to get to your quarterback.
That was the sixth sack of the game for the Texas defense. They will walk it down to the other end. And now the Longhorns are 15 minutes away from their first victory of the season. Longhorns have really unleashed a mighty offense here tonight, and the defense showing up very well, too, after the first period. And it's 48-17 Texas. And the Horns trying to win their first game of the season and getting ready for the Oklahoma Sooners next week in Dallas.
That ought to be an outstanding football game.
Tell you what, after what Oklahoma did to Texas A&M, it could be a Southwest Conference sweep for the Sooners, and, of course, Texas has won the last four in a row.
Well, I don't think Oklahoma is as good as they were. Obviously, Texas A&M isn't as bad as they were that bowl game. I don't think that was a true Oklahoma or the true A&M team. One of those circumstantial-type things with all the problems they had that week. But next week is going to be a real test for Texas.
Aggies look awfully tough today in Lubbock. That's Emerson Allen in motion. Josh LaRocca. Pressure from the backside. Nice pass and catch. That's Howard. Touchdown, Rice. What a great grab by Ed Howard, the big 6'4 junior out of Willis. He went high at about the 5-yard line and brought it in for a quick six.
Amazing game, man. He dropped. That's a great, great play with that catch for the touchdown.
I saw him go up high several times this season to make great catches. You knew he had it in him.
Well, the Rock was under a lot of pressure here when he threw that ball up in the air. Of course, the missed tackle there helps him get it into the end zone, but excellent catch by Howard. Good concentration that time. That's what he didn't have before.
31 yards on the pass and run play. LaRocca shows a pretty good arm. Getting down the extra point is Johnny Bagwell. So Rice opens up the fourth quarter with Lightning. 48-24. 72 points.
Good look at the touchdown now. Up back pass. Really gets under pressure here. He's watching Howard all the way. Got banged around pretty good. And see, that's the difference. This time Howard goes up. He looked that ball all the way into his hands. Caught it, protected it there to take it into the end zone.
Ed, I got to think the pro scouts are going to be looking at this Ed Howard as he gets older. And there's LaRocca.
Well, he's going to have to get a little more consistent with those hands. And one thing that the pro people don't like is inconsistency. The guy who makes a great play and drops two others.
But you know what he did? He went up and caught it with his hands. The two he dropped, he allowed them to come to his chest first. And, you know, rather than
the first two, he tried to run. Looked like he tried to run, Bill, before he caught the ball. He was looking where the defensive backs were and tried to take off. That one was a great one. Of course, he's just a junior. He's got another year to learn and you know, more experience, more confidence in his hands.
One thing, we haven't had any long drives tonight. 80 yards and 321 on that drive by Rice. Fred Goldsmith watching a little bit too late. This will be returnable by Adams at the 6. Got some blocking. Cuts right. Adams at the 30. Across the 40 to about the 45-yard line. And he was brought down by Jay LeMay. 40-yard return by Adams. I think his problem is Texas had 11 men on the field. He needs 9 men.
That was on the punt return.
Yeah.
They're good blocking up there, opening up the holes. You just can't come down and throw your body into the blocker just, you know, to show how tough you are on covering kickoffs. The guy who comes down and really hits people, you know, they're taking themselves out of the play by just going down and going into the blockers. You got to get under control and then try to slide off and make the play. Rice is giving great enthusiasm, but question their judgment a little bit on running into some of them blockers.
Adams has 143 return yards. There's Brown going left. He's adding to his total inside Rice territory. Brought down at the 45 of Rice. That may be good enough for a Texas first down. Jeffrey Mercer and Duque Kalu on the tackle. Kalu is a good one, and we ought to spotlight him. He's a 6'4 freshman out of San Antonio, one of the very highly recruited freshmen in the offseason. Brown now up to 178 yards rushing tonight. 13 carries.
Yeah, a lot of fun on that Texas sideline. Nice ball game. First time this year they've had this kind of fun.
Well, it's good for a young team to get a win like this under its belt, because they're going to be going into the pit in the Cotton Bowl next week. Why in the world Oklahoma would want to move that game? That's been one of the great venues for college football.
Well,
State Fairgrounds. I know OU wants to move it to its home turf, but
well,
still,
it's a home game for Texas, and it figures a home turf for Texas, so
they get the same amount of tickets.
That's why you asked. I understand what they're thinking is. They've gotten the panties beat for a few years, so you're looking for reasons of why the game should be moved or something. Change something.
There's the Kalu kid again, along with Larry Izzo and Duque Kalu. 6'4 freshman out of San Antonio. Keep an eye on him. He's going to be around a lot.
Well, after Oklahoma, Texas gets SMU, Texas Tech at Houston. All games they will figure to win.
Second down, Texas needs 11. Play action. Prince wide open. Roderick Walker inside the 25 to the 23-yard line. Nathan Bennett made the tackle for Rice. And boy, we're seeing this young man now grow up right in front of your eyes. 24 yards on the completion, and he shows you the gun he has.
Well, read the coverage perfectly. Either that or someone busted an assignment for Rice, because there's no one, as you can see, within 10 yards of it when he catches the football. Then it finally comes across and makes the play. And I don't know whether that's responsibility or not, but someone missed an assignment for Rice.
Ball on the 22-yard line. Morantz across the middle. He's got a man. Mike Adam, touchdown, Texas.
Well, Rice's defense right now is just a little bit secondary-wise. Have to be confused on their coverage. Those two plays right down the middle where there wasn't anybody within 10 yards of them. Aaron Stanley, a freshman from Friendswood. One of the safeties that's in there getting some experience.
Is that Lavelle Pinckney? I think it might be on the sidelines, congratulating his teammate, Mike Adams.
And you can just look down the middle to see that's nobody home. Nobody home now. It would appear that probably Stanley ran up to cover the underneath man, and the play went over his head. Of course, that's a freshman mistake usually.
Seven more points for Texas. The Longhorns, 55, and the Rice Owls, 24, and we still have 13 minutes left to play. Now the Longhorns came out of their Southwest Conference opener tonight with a vengeance. And they're pouring it on the Rice Owls, 55-24. Mike Adams with his first touchdown catch of the season.
Well, he got maximum protection, kept both backs in. Right down the middle, Adams come from the left into the middle. Nobody home at the free safety position for the Rice Owls. Moran said, that's another touchdown pass. If I keep going tonight, I'll catch up with those interceptions. I've had six interceptions this year.
Well, 13 of 24 for Moran, and Chad Lucas, the young junior out of Katy now, will warm up to come in. But this is a much different situation to be relieving Moran. You're coming in for the save rather than trying to get the win.
Yeah, we've done too much baseball, Bill. There's no saves and all that in football. Coming in to mop up in football.
Well, there are too many points ahead for him to get the save. But I know his mother and daddy would rather hear save than mop up.
Well, he's going to get some valuable experience that he needs, and that's exactly what you need, because you never know, somewhere along the line when Rams gets dinged a little bit, that he has to go in and play in big ball games.
I'll tell you what, too, if they start finding a way to get Adams that football more around that goal line, look out. Well, this Texas has been unbelievable. They have only been stopped one time in this game, and it was on the first possession of the game.
They went on fourth down and were stopped on fourth down. Other than that, they have put points on the board or were stopped by the halftime clock.
It's an absolute machine that we're seeing, John Makovic. And I think you get a little idea of what kind of offense he will have when he gets it running on all cylinders. Rice back up the middle right to the 20-yard line. Washington returning on the play.
The one thing that there's a little bit of concern still with the Texas will be the fact that their defense at this point did give up 24 points in three quarters. They're not going to be moving the ball, obviously, against all the teams where they've moved it here against Rice. That's to be a little concern from the defensive standpoint of Texas.
And they'll see an Oklahoma team next week that passes the ball a lot more than it used to. Watson Brown, the former coach, head coach at Rice, now running that offense at OU. Nancy Edmonds cuts it up over left tackle. Trey Thomas, another freshman. Chris Carter on the tackle also.
Well, Yancey started early in the first quarter. Looked like he was going to make some pretty good yardage running the ball, but he slowed down a little bit since then.
Down and 10 for Rice. 12:35 left to play in the game. Longhorns busted this one open in the second quarter, and it's been off to the races. Allen, little job of making a miss until he got to about the 30-yard line. Chris Rapp on on the tackle, a senior out of Dallas. Coming back, but the freshmen now are starting to get a little more playing time.
Well, Jason Reeves and Rapp have been fighting back and forth for that position all year. Of course, Reeves got hurt early in the ballgame.
Chris Hall comes out wide to the left along with Emerson Allen and Howard. Allen in motion. LaRocca across the middle. He's got Allen. And he cannot elude a tackler. Fumble, and it looks like Rice may have gotten on the ball. Pascalwani, Chris Carter were right there for Texas, but it looked like that Yancey Edmonds was there to jump on the ball for Rice.
Yeah, I thought maybe he was down. I thought they might say that he was down before he fumbled it. Let's take a look at it here and see. Good protection this time. Has the time to wait in the pocket. There's the tackle. I thought his knee was down before the ball came out.
I agree with you. I think so.
All right, we'll have to get the NFL officials to go look over that one and see if we can work on that next week. Get that straightened out.
Another one of those smallish Rice receivers, but they are quick. Allen at 5'6". We talk about Edmonds, a running back at 5'8", Costin at 5'9", but then you go Crow at 6'2", and Howard at 6'4". Good stable of receivers for the Owls. There's Allen. Got around Thomas, got into Texas territory at about the 48-yard line. Gain of about 8 on the play.
You know, Bill, that's one of the few missed tackles that we've seen Texas make this season.
Yep.
That was one of the few missed tackles. They have been tackling well.
LaRocca looks sharp tonight.
Done a good job since he's been in there under these circumstances.
Rice needs 3. Just inside Texas territory. Will the flags go? I guess he got back. Edmonds cannot get across the line of scrimmage. Maybe gained a yard. There's Thomas Baskin, and there was a flag on the other end.
Came from the far side. And they called Texas for being offside. So it'll be a first down for Rice.
You see Shea Morentz, and boy, what a night and a turnaround in the season. He might be able to look at this Rice game as the turnaround in his young career.
That's three touchdowns. He had 3 touchdown passes, 2 in the first half and 1 to Adams there with those stats.
First and 10 for Rice inside the 44-yard line. 10-11 and counting left to play. There's a bootleg. LaRocca going long. He's got Howard wide open. Can he stay in bounds? He does. Inside the 10 and about the 9-yard line. Boy, he was wide open. LaRocca took a shot. And boy, the young man showed me something. He had to hang in there, and he took a shot to the rib cage just as he released the football.
Got Texas in a 2-deep coverage, and the safety neglected to take. Safety took a bad angle to get to the play. There's the hit after he delivers it.
Ryan Johnson all over it.
And here's the catch at the end of it. Good concentration. Does stay in bounds. And there's the
man Malone coming over late.
Recover a little bit late.
Well, LaRocca has looked sharp tonight for a quarterback who hasn't played that much this season.
Texas coming this play. They're going to blitz. There it is. First option. Oh, that should be a good gainer. Needed one block and didn't get it. They run the option. First option they played. Good audible. LaRocca must have audible to this, Bill, because it's the first option that they've called, and it's against the blitz. Texas is showing blitz. They're coming. He recognized it. Option's a good play to run against the blitz because you got everybody inside. The big tackle had gotten down and made a block on the outside. Burton, Everett Burton, sophomore from Willow Ridge. He'd have gotten the block out there. They could have taken it to the end zone.
Second down. 3 yards needed for a Rice touchdown with 9:52 and counting. Yancey Edmonds. Tackle right at the line of scrimmage. perfect. Got Chris Carter coming up off the bottom of the pile, along with Rapp and Bosick.
Bosick came around from the outside, came around the outside tackle, and just knifed down in there.
The Rockets so far, 5 of 7 since coming into the game for Bert Emanuel for 87 yards.
Well, he's explaining something. He's talking to some of those offensive linemen in this huddle. He would tell those offensive linemen something about blocking. I'll guarantee it. Let's see what they call. He was emphatic.
Yeah, he was saying block for Edmonds, but again, Chris Rapp was the first one in there along with Thomas Baskin. They really shut it down. It looked like Edmonds had clear shape, sailing, and then all of a sudden, there was a big orange cloud.
Every fourth down, they will go for it. But see now, he's got to lower that shoulder and go forward. He's just getting knocked sideways. Didn't have much chance or opportunity to do it. Texas putting on a little goal line defense show here.
Well, the Longhorns want to keep him out of the end zone. Calls a timeout. He went up to the line of scrimmage, and I don't think he had the personnel he wanted.
Well, there's only 7 seconds left on the 25-second clock, too, so maybe a combination of both.
8:34 left to play in the game, and Texas on its way to the first win of the season. Well, it's Texas up on Rice with 8:34 left, and let's go down to the field. Bill Land.
Thanks, Bill. Being down here all night on the sidelines, both these teams have impressed me, and Texas, for obvious reasons, a score, but maybe the not-so-obvious reasons, their sideline demeanor, that they know that tougher games are ahead. You haven't seen a lot of ridiculous celebrating here. They're proud of what they've done, and I think what they've accomplished, but they know this one's not over yet. The other side, Rice has shown a lot of character. They aren't down at all. In fact, when LaRocca threw that touchdown pass, the first one to meet him was Emmanuel, and they're all up on the bench over there now, as you can see, and I'm just impressed with the attitudes of both these teams. I think there's good days ahead for both squads.
All right, Bill, thank you. And now LaRocca back out on the field on fourth down for Rice, needing one for the touchdown. I'm impressed with the coaching. Two well-coached teams out here tonight.
Well, they're good coaches here at Southwest Conference. No question of that. Maybe some kind of rollout, I would think, Bill. I don't think he'd stay in the pocket, or I don't think he'd run it. I think he's going to roll it out, I would guess.
Allen in motion. LaRocca goes to Allen. Just a little too tall, and Texas holds at the goal line. Chris Carter was coming like a play.
That was a tough angle pass to throw. A very difficult type pass to throw because LaRocca didn't get himself rolled out enough. Maybe he wasn't supposed to, but if he got out, he had a little bit better angle to throw that pass. See, he steps up real short, and now the angle for Carter to close and the angle for it to be caught. A very difficult catch for a receiver.
Well, after you see it again, you can see Fred Goldsmith. Oh, he says, why couldn't he catch it? Rice has been the victim of several drop passes here tonight. So Texas will have it back on its own, just about 1 yard line. And Chad Lucas checks in as the quarterback now for Texas.
It's a running formation, high formation.
Hand off in the backfield. Anthony Holmes on the carry. Well, there you see the stats on Chad Lucas, a very spirited battle. In fact, Lucas was the number one quarterback in the spring drills.
Chad looked like he was squinting a little bit over that sideline to try to pick up those the play, the formation of the play from the coaching staff.
I know how he beat
it. Good shot and good camera.
Under 8 minutes left to play in the game. Hand off again to Holmes. Cutting up to the left, across the 10 to about the 12, and boy, does he draw a crowd. First, Sean Washington in the game. But that Holmes is showing me something here tonight. He's a good one. Couple of touchdown runs. Look at Gerald Crawford gets a pretty good block for him. Hard to bring him down. He weighs 195 pounds.
Say it's
past your bedtime, young man. It's after 10 o'clock. That's those youngsters know they're supposed to go to bed early, Bill.
This game is moving into 3 hours and 30 minutes past my bedtime. Lucas going to go long for Adams at about the 45-yard line. Gives you a little idea of what kind of arm Mr. Lucas has.
Well, he can air it out, too. Look at him. Look.
Threw that ball about 50 yards in the air.
Watch him look over against those plays to the sideline. Looking pretty good hit. The end of the play.
Tell you what, though, he's a tough kid.
Coming after him. Just as delivers. Well, you got to learn to relax and let yourself go when you get hit like that. Well, second long. Let's see if they continue their pattern of running the ball after that incomplete pass on first down.
Left, second down, 10, Texas. Got a handoff, Roderick Walker. Cuts it up across the 15 to about the 18-yard line. Nathan Bennett on the tackle for Rice. Well, Chad Lucas will finish it up, but I'm very impressed with Shea Morenz tonight. Finishes up 13 of 24, 193 yards, three touchdowns tonight for the freshman redshirt.
And John Fike, junior tight end from Austin in there now. Phillips, Whetstone, that's a backup offensive lineman on the play.
Back in the shotgun. Third down, Texas needs four. Lucas going long, that'll be intercepted by Bennett. Bennett cuts back to the right, he's got some blockers. He's at the 15, he could score at the 5. Touchdown Rice, Nathan Bennett on the interception. That ball intended for Justin McLemore, but you could see it coming as Lucas threw into the zone, and the big free safety, Nathan Bennett, made the interception, returned it 39 yards for a Rice touchdown.
And that broke a string of about 9 straight possessions that they scored.
Question why Texas is throwing in this situation.
Well, I think he's trying to give Lucas some experience, Bill. I don't think he's trying to run up the score as much as he's trying to give Lucas experience. Good break on the ball by Ben, and a good return. He does a good job of returning this. Makes that final move to get to the outside. Now it's a foot race into the end zone, and he knows that he's got it. That's a good return by him.
Tell you what, he is a good one. That's his third interception this season for Nathan Bennett. Out of San Antonio, he also is one of the leading tacklers for the Owls. Very physical free safety, and he was roaming his territory.
Texas had to take a timeout, Bill. I believe he only had 9 men on the field for the extra point.
That sounds familiar. Texas 55, Rice 30. We'll be back in a moment.
Welcome back to the Southwest Conference Game of the Week on Prime Network. Because of time constraints, we now move ahead in our coverage.
I think, you know, when it's all said and done and all put out of the way, again, I think that November the 25th meeting where they've got to go into A&M and take a look at that now. Uh-oh. Mike Adams, those 143 yards is a new school record kickoff return.
They've had some pretty good athletes come down the pike here.
And add to it, maybe.
Well, he gets up to the 25-yard line before he goes down on the play.
And add to that newly established record.
Well, Bill Land, what's up down on the field?
Well, hello, fellas. You guys were talking a little bit about the Red River Roundup and talking about OU and Texas next weekend. There's something a little bit new now with the OU-Texas game. Unfortunately, it's been marred by a little bit of violence in some of the nights before the game. This year, the Red River Roundup, Texas OU weekend in Dallas, October 8 and 10. I'm looking at a fold-out here that must have 35 different events surrounding the football game for all ages. And if people want more information, the event info hotline is 1-214-746-6679. That's the event information hotline, 214-746-6679. And hopefully a lot of folks will head to Dallas and have a good, safe, wonderful weekend as Texas and Oklahoma battle next Saturday.
All right, Bill, I think you'll be okay if you stay off Commerce Street. That's where some action happened the night before.
I would never know a thing about any of that.
But you were always coaching professional football.
Never got out on the street.
One of the great rivalries, though, coming down the tunnel at the Cotton Bowl for that Texas OU game is the kids tell you that it's something you just can't believe. There's a good run by Walker, lost his balance, got it back. Here's a junior out of Irving, and he can pick him up and lay him down. Bennett on the tackle for Rice.
Oh, there's a lot of great rivalries in college football. I just said that Texas OU is really one of the good ones. And interesting games going around the nation this evening.
.525 and counting. Chad Lucas in from the bullpen for Shea Morenz tonight. Morenz with a super job. Lucas throwing again, and he's got his receiver. And there's Mr. Hands, Matt Davis.
You know, I think the same thing. This is to give all of this right now is to give Lucas confidence that the coaching staff believes in him. He threw the interception, and they're coming back, and they're still saying, "Hey, we believe in you. Let's work. Let you work on the passing game."
Hey, Davis is an intriguing youngster. He's a freshman out of Fort Worth. Played for his dad in high school. He's 6'5", 207. And he, there you'll see him come out. He's at the top of your screen in the huddle, and he's got great hands. I've watched him practice. He just doesn't drop very many balls. It's a nice big target to throw to.
Our quarterbacks love that.
And of course, with Pinckney at 6'5", Texas has got some height in its receiving corps. There's Mr. Holmes again. Anthony Holmes on the run. Tonight, along with Gerald Crawford, Phil Brown, Roderick Walker, Curtis Jackson. John Makovic and his staff trying to bring the horns back to those glory years. Darryl Royal.
And you can still see him coaching on the sideline, working the game, working hard, teaching.
Holmes again. Nice little move. You know, that's what you look for in a running back. When he saw the hole, he really turned on.
He's got that little extra burst.
Yeah.
I think that's what you're searching for. He saw that hole, and he had that burst and ability to get through it and turn it on. Kind of shifted from first gear into second gear. Another little extra gear.
He didn't dance.
That's right.
Put on the jets. Went straight ahead.
Good backs have that extra. They have a little bit extra in that gas tank.
So it's first and 10 for Texas. And the Longhorns now content to just run this clock out. Pitch back again. And Holmes trying to get inside the 40-yard line. He does. And Jeff Sowles on the tackle.
Now Sowles made quite a few tackles this evening. Another group of youngsters. They had no curfew here in Austin, Bill?
Not on game night.
Oh, okay.
3 minutes left to play in the game. So the Longhorns now will go to 1-2-1. Rice will fall to 3-2. Rice has TCU next week. Texas has the Sooners. In the backfield, great balance on the play. There's a flag on the play right at about the 40-yard line. Gerald Crawford, 6'1 senior out of Sherman. He's been doing most of the blocking for Holmes tonight, but that time he got the carry.
This usually in the direction of holding. Let's see what the call is.
Well, we'll watch the penalty again. You look at that Texas sideline. We talked about how big a game this is for Rice tonight.
The penalty.
But John Mayer does a column for the Austin American-Statesman. He has been an observer of Texas football for many years, Ed, and he wrote a column today where he said it's not just a game or a season on the line for Texas tonight, but it could be an entire program.
Now, that's I thought he got carried away a little bit with that column, Bill. I mean, that was a little carried away.
But John has been an observer of Texas football for years.
Yeah, but no, but there's one game that's going to make or break any program.
But it certainly does give them a lot of momentum.
Yes, but I mean, looking at the flip side of this, everybody here realizes that he's building with these freshmen and sophomores.
somehow or other Rice had won this ball game, then it wouldn't have been the end of the world. Their program would have continued to build. And I thought that was one of those stretch newspaper articles.
Well, it's been a program that has only gone 50-46-1 in the last 97 games, and I think that's what he was concerned about in his article, was the fact that you've got to kind of turn this thing around, although I think it'll take John, and that's a good job by Lucas of throwing that ball away. There was a flag on the play.
I think we're going to find Rice probably offsides. Looks like they're trying to come with a blitz, and they got a little jumpy.
So 2:18 remaining to play on the game that would never end.
Well, but Bill, get back to what you're talking about. The college game is changing, though. They're reducing the number of scholarships, increased academic requirements. It's very difficult for a team to corral all the talent in the world now. You only give so many scholarships, and you've got to be careful who you give them to. You can't afford to have players who don't make it academically.
Well, plus, yes, the Southwest Conference not recruiting Proposition 48 players, and that hurts against some schools they play outside the conference.
Don't
understand that, but
question that again.
I still think this is a huge game for the Texas program because Rice was improving, and they never have gone undefeated after four games. Except you have to go all the way back to a Dana Bible team in the early years. So this was a win. It got Texas, got the young team the experience of winning.
Hey, we're finally got, is this what I think it is?
A punt.
The very first one of the evening.
Dwayne Bosick will finally get to punt. Now, look at the average. He's number 10 in the nation. He doesn't want to squib one here.
Well, he'll punt it through the end zone. He'll get credit. Take a 5-yard penalty, drop it back. That was average.
Returning it all the way for a touchdown is Derek Williams of the Rice Owls.
Now you see why they don't punt.
Well, the Rice Owls have come up with some spectacular plays in the fourth quarter. The defense with an interception. And now Derek Williams with a blocked punt to return it all the way. And that says something for that Allen program.
Yeah, I think that, you know, that, again, when you look and see things like that, that came off the drawing board. Coaching staff found something in the protection. Let's see, Vasek, see what he does. One. He two. Oh, no, he laid out. That was good. Nothing wrong except they overloaded. See the overload on the right? Overload on the right. Two of them coming between the man who was supposed to block out there. He made the decision to go one way. Another man got the block.
Looked like Bo Valleys on the block for Rice. And the Owls put up the extra point, and it's 55-38 with 1:19 left to play. And I'm sure when we come back, we'll see an onside kick.
Well,
the Rice Owls have gotten an interception and a block punt for a couple of touchdowns here in the fourth quarter. And we'll check out the scores around the conference today. The Aggies, boy, I'll tell you, they look strong today going into Lubbock and defeating Texas Tech 31-6. SMU at Missouri really fought hard. I'll tell you what, the Mustangs,
they've
come a long way, and it's 10-10 final on somebody else's. How about this win for Kim Helton? What a great job by that Houston coaching staff, 24-3 over a highly favored Baylor team.
Two great goal line stands by the Houston defense and TCU. Respectable outing against Oklahoma State.
And remember now, TCU is young also. That's a very young team playing a lot of freshmen. Here's the onside kick. It gets the high bounce. Rice wants. It's tipped up in the air. Good job by Texas. And I don't know who that was flying through the air, but he tipped the ball to Cosmo Palmieri. Good hands by Palmieri, but somebody came flying through and kind of tipped the ball to him. You always put your good hands on the receiving team.
Well, that's perfect onside kick. So you get the bounce, the second bounce, then you get the high bounce. That's what you want. That's a perfect onside kick. just couldn't quite get there to hit him.
Well, a good job. I thought that was a heck of a kick.
It was. It was perfect. Well, two defensive scores by Rice here, interception and a punt block.
There's a handoff to Holmes again over right guard, and I think John Makovic will play it close to the vest now. 93 points, Ed, scored in this game tonight.
That's almost like an old-time basketball score, 55 to 38. Yeah, some basketball game 3 years ago wasn't that high score.
That's right. And Tom Penders,
well,
sitting in the stands, would like to score.
Let's see, when maybe one more running play, and then
well, you only have one back. Everybody on the line of scrimmage. There's Holmes again over left tackle inside the 40-yard line. That's good for a Texas first down, and Horns will run it out now. Aaron Stanley on the stop for the Rice Owls.
We've got to have one more. Have to have one more snap because there's still 35 seconds on the clock.
First and 10, 27 and counting now. Had over 900 yards total offense in this game tonight.
He's probably over 1,000 by now.
There's Anthony Holmes. Good cut to the right side. He's inside the 30 to about the 27-yard line before he's tackled on the play. And Holmes tonight, 15 carries for 87 yards. But Bill Brown was the real workhorse.
Wind the clock out there, official. Come on, it's 5 seconds on the clock. Wind it, let it go.
Well, that's John Makovic and Fred Goldsmith were on their way to congratulate each other. And
well, that was an official standing out there, going to go through the formalities of moving the change 10 yards before they wound them again.
Now, two coaches building their programs, and the streak continues tonight. Texas wins for the 28th straight year over the Rice Owls, 55-38. They'll put the orange lights on the tower tonight here in the Hill Country. Well, that's always a happy sight in the Hill Country when the orange lights are on the tower, and they are tonight. Here is tonight's just plain smart play of the game. And it came on the second possession. A blitz by Texas. Everybody on the line of scrimmage. Burt Emanuel sees it, changes the play, and takes off to the races. A 50-yard run, and it put the Owls up by the score of 10-7. But after that, it was all Longhorn. That's tonight's play of the game brought to you by Southwest Airlines. It's just plain smart. Texas wins for the first time this season. We'll be back with more in just a moment. Well, we welcome you back to Memorial Stadium in Austin, and tonight's Southwest Conference football game has been brought to you by Southwest Airlines, offering frequent flights and low everyday fares, which is why flying Southwest Airlines is just plain smart. Well, a lot of folks down on the field, and I think our Bill Land is down there somewhere.
Thanks, Bill. Yeah, kind of a mob scene down here as they celebrate the first Texas win of the year. I guess in wrapping up my thoughts on this one, the word hungry comes to mind for Texas. What a hungry football team. And so much said all week long about this team needing to develop a personality and some type of identity. Well, they established it tonight with the run early, and then later on, Morenz with the big passing plays and big plays all night both ways, as we saw just a moment ago. And a huge win, I think, for Texas to get them in a good frame for the big battle against the University of Oklahoma next week. As for Rice, dropping to 3-2, nothing to be ashamed of with the great effort that they showed throughout here. I think they're still going to win a lot of football games, and they got a chance to bounce right back next week against TCU down in Houston.
All right, Bill, thank you so much. We appreciate your efforts down on that field here tonight. Well, Ed Biles, there have been a lot of Rice Owls waiting many, many years to beat Texas. They'll have to wait another 28 straight victories for Texas.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think Rice really played Texas at probably the worst possible time they could. Texas with the first time in many years that they going into a season with no wins in their first three ball games. They're playing at home. They were getting a lot of flack from the newspapers up in this particular area. Rice had to come up here. I think he just really played him. Timing from a schedule standpoint has a lot to do with a lot of things. The worst possible time for Rice to play him. Some positives left to Rice. They did play hard. They hung in there. If they can go back home and prepare themselves for TCU next week, they can win their fair share of football games for the season. Obviously, a good win for Texas, a win that they really needed at this stage of the year.
Ed, thanks so much.
Enjoyed it, Bill.
We'll see you down the road. I'd like to remind you that coordinating producer of Home Sports Entertainment is Mike Anastasiou. Tonight's telecast, produced by Murphy Brown and directed by Mike Anastasiou. Technical director, Mark Alsmeyer. Engineer in charge, George McDaniel. And remote facilities provided by Sportscom. Once again, tonight's final score, Texas 55 and Rice 38. For Ed Biles, Bill Land, and all of us at HSE, I'm Bill Worrell saying so long from Memorial Stadium in Austin, Texas. This has been another...